So Ross, big game coming up tonight against Essex. How important is a win for qualification chances?
Yeah, obviously it's pretty close up top now. You know, three wins for us with three home games is going to be crucial, I think. But maybe two gets us through. But yeah, obviously we're looking to win all three.
How confident are yourself and the team that you can pick up 2 points here?
Well, obviously we take confidence from the game we played here against them last year, and also the game we played against them at their place early on in the season. So the boys are actually doing really well. Obviously a tough result the other night. You know, weather obviously played a big part in that. But yeah, we're full of confidence and the guys are firing well.
And as you mentioned, despite the defeat to Gloucestershire, you're an unbeaten 41. How pleasing was it to get in the runs?
Yeah, it's obviously been frustrating for me so far this year. Been, you know, scrapping away and you know, obviously got a few runs to get us to a nice total the other night. But, you know, that's gone. So hopefully, you know, today we can pile on a few more runs.
And just finally, how much are you looking forward to playing back here in front of the Ageas Bowl crowd, and do you think they can help you tonight?
Yeah, we've got a nice run in actually, you know, three home games. The boys are really looking forward to that. We've been on the road quite a lot, so that's tiring in itself. So we're looking forward to a bit of energy from the crowd, and yeah, that'll definitely get us through these next three games.
And he's gone. They're just going through a kind of transitional period, you feel, a little bit with their T20 side. Straight up in the air. This will be easy pickings for James Vince at deep mid-off. And suddenly Surrey are 4-2. So, Donald Stroke Turner is in. He's in the slot this time, and that is 4. Got him. Surrey are 3 down. Clothed it to mid on, and that's 4 down. Chris Jordan has played that very nicely, and that does run away for the second boundary. The pitch he produced for the World Test Championship was marvellous. Another one. Oh, he's claimed him, and the finger is up, and he's gone. He swept this fine, and it will just beat the man. Much needed boundary.
Hooked out to the square leg boundary. Will it be caught? No. Drops in the gap just short of the rope. That is hit to the man at mid-off, and the story of the innings continues. Anyway, Ellis to continue. Tom Curran facing. Driven well, driven beautifully on the up, through the covers for 4. What is the problem? And they might have one here.
And on cue, Cam.
They do have one here. Second tier from Jamie Overton. Free hit, heaved over to the leg side. Is it 6? By my eyes, that's gone. Phil will likely go full. He does. Is he heaved? Is he caught? He's not caught. Another 6 run. And that's clipped away.
Fantastic over for Surrey and Jamie Overton.
In the latter half of this over. It's there. It's in the slot. It's hit high. But he's not got enough of it. Mid on is under it. Nicely done. Bowled in. Off the inside edge. Maybe even a bit of pad. But he's gone. In the slot, bowled in. Bowled in, that's your lot. 124 all out. Chris Wood has the final say. He's gone again. This one's even further. That's all the way. Oh, and he's dropped it in the crowd. Shot. Shot of the day. Have some more. Thank you very much. Ben McDermott again, as you said, Cameron, he seems to have a sixth sense. Short, wide, carved. Lands on the rope for mine. Now broken into the four-day team. That's hit hard by McDermott on the top of the bounce. Climbed into that. That's gone high.
and it's cleared the two men on the leg side boundary comfortably in the end.
Lights are on now, the clouds are moving in.
Vince into the gap. It will run away for four. Vince goes long, effortless off the hip. He's gone up for it, and he's been given. He's been given a little feather through. He's been broadly unhittable.
There's that James Vince pull shot.
James Vince, more. Brilliantly, brilliant effort down there. That's edged and will run away for four. That's also in the gap. I think it will be cut off. In fact, that sums up Surrey's afternoon. Sean Abbott with the sprawling dive. And have another one. Glorious. Abbott into Vince. Short, pulled. And that will be it. Nobody out at deep mid-wicket. Effortless, easy on the eye. And a relentless run machine. James Vince, who wanted runs against Surrey, he's gone and got them.
Fielding's Vitality Blast game between the Hampshire Hawks and the Essex Eagles. Another really important one in terms of qualification for the quarterfinals. Delighted to be joined by Simon Lee, head groundsman here at the Ageas Bowl. Simon, we're going to start with non-cricket because it is the elephant in the room for anyone coming into the ground this evening. The Arctic Monkeys concert was, just over a week ago now. Yep. You've had a very busy week, I understand, getting the ground back for cricket.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So 8 days ago was the concert. We didn't actually get the ground back fully without anything on it until Sunday afternoon. So we've only really had 4 full days before today to get the game going. So it's been a tight turnaround, a few extra hours, lots of water and lots of products put onto the outfield. But look, you can still see it. You can see the stage area, the trackway we use for the lorries and the forklifts to come on to build the stage and by the tunnel as well. So you can't hide these things. We've done everything we can to make sure it's playable, and it is 100% playable. So yeah, so you can't hide these things, but it's fine for cricket, which is the main thing.
The ground staff always want, I guess, a bit of rain here and there to help you out. It's been pretty much non-rain for the last week or so since then. Has that been helpful or a hindrance in terms of getting the ground back where you want it?
It's actually been a hindrance. I mean, building up to the concert, it was 28 degrees plus in here for 5 days in a row. I couldn't water anything because of the build. So the outfield suffered because it was so hot and because I couldn't water. We could have done with a little bit of rain and it just would have kept everything a little bit more alive. So always a groundsman, you're never quite happy, are you really? So yeah, it's warm now. We've been able to put some irrigation on it. We've had a few little storms, so it's slowly recovering and it will keep recovering over the next couple of weeks.
And for you, when the concert's going on, are you here watching from somewhere thinking, oh, what are they doing or whatever? How did you treat that sort of 24 hours?
I quite enjoyed it, to be honest. But,
not the music.
I'm a music fan, so I quite enjoyed it. And weirdly, the 30,000-odd people that were here didn't really affect the grass at all. It was all the infrastructure for building, staging and de-rigging. That was the thing, the issues we've had. So the actual people in has not caused a problem.
And just finally on that one, before we get onto the wicket itself, does this sort of areas around us, the trackways and things, does that recover this season or is that going to take an off-season to recover now?
I think it's 50-50. We've actually reseeded the whole area. So we've put fresh seed in. We've top-dressed it 2 days ago. Obviously, that will germinate and come through and green up. So some of it, I say, has burnt. So it's unlikely it's going to recover. So that's why we've seeded up to try and get the grass to thicken up and have an even surface.
Let's just come onto this wicket then. Let's get James, our cameraman, to pan around a little bit. This is a fresh one for the Blast this season.
Yep, so pitch shape, fresh one. We've moved over to the other side of the square compared to the two pitches we've used already this season. Theory being we were a little bit further away from the stage. And obviously we've got three games this Friday, next Friday and Sunday. So hopefully we'll be using this one for all those three games with our championship match wedged in the middle.
Yeah, and we expect consistent performance across the square, of course. So again, we're looking at the sort of 160, 170, 180
area. We pushed the boundaries back out for our last game to 75, but we brought them back into 72 for this. We've had to bring it in to 65 by the tunnel just because of some of the damaged area from the concert. I always think 170 you're in the game, but I mean at the moment scores around the country have been huge, so who knows what's going to happen.
Yeah, you must have been watching the oval last night. That's thinking mad. Flat as anything.
Yeah, absolutely mad. I mean, we're oval's a little bit smaller boundaries here and there in the corners, so we're always a little bit bigger as an entity as a whole, so scores are always a little bit lower here just because we are so big.
Simon, great insight as ever, thanks for joining us. Simon Lee, head groundsman here at the Ageas Bowl.
And a very warm welcome to the Ageas Bowl, Friday night T20. Can't beat it with the sun out. We've been so lucky here this season with all the home games, where it's been absolutely boiling hot. We've had good crowds, and we are set for another good crowd tonight, because this is a big game as we get towards the end of the group matches in the South Group for both these sides, not just for Hampshire. I'm Kevin James. Next to me, Southern Vipers batter Emily Windsor. Three games to go in this group, Emily, and there's a lot at stake for both these sides.
Yeah, for me, this is, rightly as you said, this is an absolutely huge game. I think in the group stage, when we get to this back end, they're all must-win games in this competition, and not only to try and qualify, but we saw last year the momentum Hampshire got when they started winning those back group games. If you do make those quarter-finals, semi-finals, finals, you want that confidence within your group. So for both teams, must win tonight.
Certainly is. Now, Hampshire have won the toss and will bowl first, so Essex will have a bat. Both these sides, even though they haven't been in the best of form recently, occupy two of the top four slots, and that's exactly where teams need to be come the 14th game, because then you qualify for the quarter-finals. Essex sit third. They have 14 points from 11 played. Hampshire have 12 in fourth, and they have also played 11. But Hampshire have lost three of their last four, and Essex have lost their last two, Emily.
Yeah, as you said, both these teams have sort of had the last few games a bit of a ropey run of form, but when these two teams come head-to-head, someone's luck's going to change tonight. And I think in this competition in T20 cricket, every game is a must-win, and I think every game you can change that momentum. One standout performance, I think Hampshire heavily so far in this competition have relied on James Vince. He's been ever impressive for Hampshire and led from the front with the bat. I think there's been some small contributions from the rest of the Hampshire lineup, but James Vince averaging 70 in this competition so far, I think he's really important for Hampshire tonight.
Yeah, there's an amazing stat actually that I looked up earlier today. Five of the six occasions that James Vince has hit 50 plus, Hampshire have won. This is this season. And four of the five occasions where Vince has scored less than 50, Hampshire have actually lost.
I'm not surprised is my answer to that, and I think Hampshire fans and listeners will not be surprised by that as well. He's just so important to this Hampshire lineup, but in the way he plays and the way he leads this side.
Certainly. Should we go through the two sides? Because Hampshire have unchanged, but Essex have made two changes from the side that lost to Kent last night at home. Do you want to do Essex for us?
Of course I can. So the opening batters will be Feroz Kushi and Dan Lawrence. Michael Pepper in at three. The powerful top order that is for Essex. Robin Das, Paul Walter, Matt Critchley, Daniel Sams, a very good all-rounder. We'll bottle them with the gloves for Essex. Simon Harmer, I think everyone knows that name, captaining Essex tonight. Ben Allison and Aaron Beard are the two changes, two seamers coming into this side here at the Ageas Bowl tonight.
Yeah, Snater making way, who's a seamer, but Aaron Nijjar, the left arm, slow left armer, he makes way. Well, Hampshire then, for the fourth game running, have chosen this 11. Ben McDermott, James Vince, Toby Albert, Joe Weatherly, Ross Whiteley, James Fuller, Benny Howe, Liam Dawson, Chris Wood, Nathan Ellis and John Turner. Well, apart from that stat about James Vince, Emily, it's quite interesting. When you look at strike rates between these two sides, Essex actually the top few in their order. Are actually quite impressive numbers.
Yeah, absolutely, and I think that's going to be ever important for Hampshire here to pick up early wickets. I think the thing here at the Ageas Bowl, it tends to be a big playing surface. I think because of the Arctic Monkeys being here, the boundaries have been pulled in a little bit because of the damage to the grass. But firstly, credit to the groundsman for making it look as green and lush as it did when they first took that stage off. But look, I think it's going to be a cracker tonight. Hampshire need early wickets. Essex are going to go hard at the bowlers, and I think we could go for a lovely high scoring game like Surrey versus Middlesex last night.
What was going on there? Middlesex,
honestly, coming from zero to nothing. But that shows you the nature of T20 cricket. Someone gets on a roll, it takes one person to hold their hand up and it can really change a game.
Certainly has. Going back to the Arctic Monkeys concert here, apparently 30,000 here. Were you one of those?
I wasn't. I was on a plane to Menorca, Kev.
Oh, with your mum. Oh, lovely, yeah.
So I can't say that I saw how spectacular it was, but I heard good things from people that were here and then seen not so good things when the grass turned brown.
So it's a hot night here at the Ageas Bowl, perfect for T20. It's Harry the Hawk.
It's my favourite
part of
the day.
Do you love this? Mel loves this as well, as he's been doing.
How can you not love it? And do you know what we're trying really hard is we've had some double headers here, haven't we? Southern Vipers, Hampshire Hawks. We're trying to get Charlotte Edwards, Adam Carter, our director of cricket, to get us a Vipers mascot to do that exact thing. We actually haven't got a mascot, Kev, but gets the crowd going, doesn't it?
He might wave to you if you go to the front.
I should feel like I should queue up. I actually want his autograph.
It is a very, very hot evening. Yeah, going back to the concert is quite interesting. I mean, this outfield looks pretty decent, doesn't it, really? And speaking to Simon beforehand, he's put seaweed on it. He's done various things to help the grass re-germinate. Now down by the tunnel area where it's particularly brown, they've reseeded it and they put sand over the top and top-dressed it and what have you. And I have to say, you wouldn't really notice. I've seen a couple of outfields recently that had no concerts. And actually, this looks a lot better than those.
I'll tell you what, as well, because of the lack of cricket that's been here, how lush and green the square looks. I think if you're fielding in the ring, you're happy today. You're not diving on those old firm wicket ends and getting the grazes. It's pretty green across the square, other than that one central pitch that we're playing on.
Go on then, see if he waves to you. Harry the Hawk is coming round in front of us at the hotel. Is he going to look up? Emily is waving. Oh, I think he might have done, did he? Has he?
I don't know. Come on now. Oh. I feel like he's ignored me.
Yeah, I think he has. I'm not sure he went to third floor.
I'm going to have to go home now. I just got pied by the Hawk.
You've got to have a word. You need to have a word with Harry and get that sorted, because that's rude to just have ignored you. Don't like that, but never mind. As I say, good crowd. Lots of yellow shirts in the crowd, which is always a good sign, although Essex play in yellow shirts. So I presume... they're all Hampshire. There may just be one or two Essex fans here as well Friday night.
Yeah, I hope it'll be a good crowd. I think here, as soon as the night gets going, the atmosphere builds. And I think for Hampshire, they need the crowd behind them tonight. They've got that advantage. They know the conditions. And it's set to be a cracker, Kev. The children there that have won the Skills Challenge, waving those flags on as the umpires and Hampshire take to the field. They'll be loving it down there. When you're 6-7 waving a flag, that's your day made, isn't it?
I tell you what, they never fail these nights to really sort of just grab you a little bit, don't they? They grab you by the back of the neck, and they really do feel special occasions. We've been blessed by the weather, of course, that helps. I'm not sure whether a team's doing brilliantly or not actually makes a huge amount of difference, because if it's hot and it's a Friday, and we've had some during the school holidays as well, I think people will just come anyway because it's a good day out, good evening out.
Yeah, look, I think it's great, and I think there's been a lot of talk, hasn't there, about crowds in T20 Blast, now the hundreds on, and this summer, the Ageas Bowl here, I don't feel like I've had too much of a problem. The crowds have been absolutely excellent, and myself being part of the double headers that have been for many of these T20 games, the atmosphere here has been fantastic for us, and then stayed on and watched the boys do well here as well.
So the Hampshire team are out in the middle, the two Essex openers. They don't play in yellow. I think they used to, didn't they? But they've now got these...
I thought they're blue and red Essex.
Mauve. Yeah, they're sort of mauve.
Have Essex ever been yellow?
No. I don't know why I thought they were yellow. Why did I think that?
I thought they were blue and red. I don't know.
There might have been another colour once. Maybe it wasn't yellow. I don't know.
Maybe they had a bit of yellow on the kit or something.
Yeah, anyway. You've got to remember, I've seen 20 years of T20 cricket. You were only just about born when it started. I'm sure one or two teams have changed their colours over the years. But Chris Wood will open up from the pavilion end, the left-arm seamer. We're playing slightly to the left. It looks like a reasonably new wicket, if not a new wicket. We're not on the hybrids, just to the right. So it'll be interesting to see how this plays. But there is a little bit of a smattering of green. Along the 22 yards, but it looks like it to be a couple of brown areas as well, so maybe it might be a fraction too paced. We'll have to wait and see. So it's Dan Lawrence, the right-hander. to get us underway as Chris Woods over the wicket, left arm, bowls to Lawrence. Lawrence gets wrapped on the pad as it goes out square on the right-hand side. Now, the crowds generally have been around 7,000 for the games here, and this gives me the same sort of feeling, if I'm honest, especially away to our right, left, down by the scoreboard, around sort of back of the square leg as I look. That's always an area because it gets the sun the latest, doesn't it? There's always a load of people there, but there's an equally in the shade to our right, an awful lot by the scoreboard to our right as well. So good atmosphere here as Wood bowls. Lawrence swings that away. It's gone down to fine leg. Oh, he's missed it. Oh, my word, that's John Turner. One bounce. Now, is that the outfield? Was that the Arctic Monkeys playing some tricks?
I think John Turner would be disappointed in that. I think Hampshire pride himself on the fielding, and that's not how you want to start a game. But I'm sure he'll make up with it at the ball if he carries on performing as he has. But I'm sure Chris Woods walking back to his mark, a little frustrated there.
I have to say, I can't remember a time a fielder would miss a ball like that. It wasn't that hard, was it? As Wood bowls, he's edged over the end, over the top of a diving McDermott. And that's gone down to third for four runs.
Yeah, well, Chris Wood will be walking back to his mark even more frustrated now after that. I think as a seamer, the worst thing in the world is a nick for four. But as a batter, cheers. Says four on the scoreboard.
Do you know what? We know how quickly T20s seem to favour a side and don't. You know, it's just those nights. We've had three balls here, misfielding. That could have gone easily to the keeper. Are we already seeing a night that might not go Hampshire's way? Eight without loss, Essex. Maybe it's too early to say that as Lawrence pushes forward out towards mid-wicket. And even there, Fuller hasn't picked that up cleanly. What's going on?
Kev, don't jinx it. Don't jinx it. But do you know what? I think another factor here is when you're fielding, and as we look to the pitch to the left, the sun sets to the right and it's in your eyes, and it can be quite challenging to see that white ball. And it's not an excuse, because as professional cricketers you should be used to it, but it is a challenge that they have to adapt to.
We'll come down the wicket, Lawrence, and smashes that up towards the pavilion. That's gone a long way. And that has gone five or six rows back towards the Essex dressing room. Now that is a superb shot.
Wow. From what we've seen so far, looks like the ball's coming onto the bat pretty nicely there.
Isn't it just?
And that shot from Dan Lawrence, that'll be one for the highlight reel, that's for sure.
That's interesting. It actually is difficult. You've experienced it. Here's Wood, he is under pressure. 14 without loss in the first over. Lawrence puts that away. It's a no ball from Chris Wood. Well, this is not a great start from Hampshire at all here. And Wood's just looking at the front foot line. I don't think the umpire will be getting that wrong. And this is a free hit. That's all you need.
Yeah, and I think James Vince probably won't be too pleased with that as a captain. I know the game before Surrey, they said that they didn't start well with the ball. And James Vince was really keen for his bowlers to reply to that. They did that exactly. They started absolutely phenomenally. But here, definitely Essex's first over, that's for sure. 17 without loss.
My word, there's still another ball to bowl in this over. It's Feroz Kushi steps away, hits it way up towards mid-off, and that has gone for four. 21 off the first over, hit by Essex, having been put into bat. Well, I'm sure James Vince is already thinking, wow, is that the right decision?
Yeah, well, you can't judge, I don't think, one over. I think these two, we know, we talked to pre-show about how they're going to go hard. Their strike rates are impressive, Essex, and I think as in T20 cricket, as a seamer, you can't be too disheartened after one over. You've got to come back stronger, and we know Hampshire can do that because they've done that in many games so far in this competition.
Wow, under pressure straight away though here at Hampshire. Remember, Essex have lost their last two, Hampshire have lost their last three of four, but they both still sit in the top four places. But these sides not exactly in the best of form.
John Turner then, can he make up as he bowls and follows him? That's a good delivery. They're going to come through for a quick single. James Vince shies at the stumps and nearly slide tackles it as well. 22 without loss, and Lawrence will move to 16 off just seven balls.
It's like your field, isn't it?
What, slide tackling?
Yeah.
To be fair, slide tackling on this sand, it'll be extra yards, will it? Will it hold you up? What do you reckon?
I don't know, actually. What would it do?
Well, I have to watch and see.
I mean, basically the same lush outfield, but there are just areas you can see which have been affected by the concert. And there is a sort of a line that John Turner is actually starting his run up from. There is a line running left to right to left as we look, about 3 or 4 feet sort of thick, that has lost a lot of grass that's been reseeded. You can see that. That's definitely a brown bit in the outfield.
John Turner then just having to wait as Ben McDermott was sorting something out with the grass, but number six on his back, he's ready to charge in on the hotel end to Kushi. That's wrapped him on the pad, good pace. And a dot ball for Hampshire, a rare dot ball so far in this innings.
He's bowled well, isn't he, this year, John Turner? Playing his first season of T20 cricket, 12 wickets so far, his economy rate of 7.8. It's been a real find.
He really has, and I think he bowled well in last year's 50-over competition, but for him to come in this side and almost jump ahead of Scott Curry, who we've seen previously here, is a credit to him and the form he's in. As he's in again, bowls pace, delivery to backward a point, another dot ball for Hampshire.
Yeah, he's harried one or two batters this year as well. I mean, you always talk about T20s, don't you? You want a little bit of mystery spin, you want somebody that bowls a bit quicker than everybody else, just to give you variety, even. Mason Crane not in the side tonight, so that mystery spin not here, and hasn't been in the side for a little while now. But John Turner's providing the other end of it.
And again, short ball, that's quick and through to Ben McDermott. Exactly what you said there, Kev, rushing batters for the pace. That's one for the over, but whoo, that was ferocious.
It was, wasn't it? Now, I remember Kushi at the game at Chelmsford, which Hampshire won fairly comfortably earlier this season. They won by 118 runs. 214 for 8 Hampshire made, which Vince got 103 in that game, but Kushi was struggling, really struggling.
Turner right arm over in, and that's worked to mid wicket. Again, another dot ball. Something's building here. One ball remains and just one run from this over.
Yeah, Kushi was struggling a bit like that, really. Banged in, you know, hitting the bat, hitting high. In fact, he got a really painful blow on the hand, I remember, and I was thinking he should go off, but he actually carried on. And he really struggled, really, in his innings.
And that's the length John Turner's bowling here. The offside up, just a deep fine and square as Turner in bowls four, and that's driven down the ground. Great diving stop from Liam Dawson. And guess what? That's another dot ball, just one run from John Turner's first over. Very impressive, that, and it's high fives from his teammates. So the score, 22 without loss, Essex.
Well, that's much more like it, isn't it, really? And unfortunately, it's the youngster that's had to show the way there. 22-year-old. I don't think Chris Wood will be getting another over at this moment. But Dan Lawrence already looking particularly dangerous with 16 off just 9 deliveries. He has a great strike rate in this competition. Overall, in his career, he strikes at 140. And this season, Dan Lawrence, he's striking at 150. So he's actually improved his strike rate this season. Nathan Ellis. Well, this will be interesting. Always a mixture of paces. Still a lot of batters still struggling to pick that slower ball. Will Dan Lawrence do that? So third over, 22 without loss, and just as he was running in, it looks like somebody behind him in the pavilion was moving. And the umpire is, yeah, somebody just above the sight screen, would you believe it? And he's just walking across.
And in fact, below the sight screen as well.
Yeah, they're right over it, standing there, and I think Lawrence has decided that he's got to move. Oh, yeah, right, yeah. There's
still
two more
there.
What is going on? Where's the steward? there is no steward by the looks of it out there. Anyway, here's Nathan Ellis from that pavilion end, bowling to Lawrence, and Lawrence flicks that away, and that's going for four behind square. He looks in good touch already, doesn't he?
Looks like one of those days where wherever you bowl it, it's going to hit Dan Lawrence's middle of the bat. Dan Lawrence, of course, going to Surrey after this summer. That was a big announcement, wasn't it? Surrey just...
A few days ago. They just hoover up everybody.
Where's he going to fit in their team, Kev?
Well, that's what, when I heard that coming out, that's exactly what I thought. So where is he going to fit in? Incredible, isn't it? And apparently Essex offered him more money as well. So he's obviously gone because he really wants to go. Here's Ellis, bowls to Lawrence. Lawrence flicks that away. Fortunately, goes straight to Chris Wood on the 45. And that will be a single. So Essex move on to 27th without loss on this hottest of evenings here, just outside Southampton. Full sun not a cloud in the sky, absolutely made for T20 cricket these evenings, and we've been lucky, we've been blessed. Every single game, home game this season, has been in this sort of weather, and the crowd have responded. The numbers are good once more. We were chatting just before we came on air, actually. As Ellis comes in again, and that's hit hard over mid-on by Kushi, and that's going for six more, I think. That is. It isn't quite as far as Dan Lawrence hit it, but it's in the same area. You don't have to hit it very far over the rope to get six, and he didn't.
I think from what I've seen so far, Kev, there's not been any swing, there's not been any seam. It looks a fantastic pitch to bat on, and we were saying earlier that it's a fresh deck, and of course it has to be, as it was covered for the Arctic Monkeys, so I feel like we're in for a high-scoring thriller here.
Certainly at the moment, 33 without loss, and we're only halfway through the third. Kushi gives himself some room, hits that into the ground, and the crowd thinks that's a catch by Ross Whiteley, but I'm afraid it was hit straight into the ground first.
Why didn't Ross Whiteley play with the crowd there? See, if that was me in the field, Kev, I'd be throwing up pretending to celebrate.
You'd have played up to it, wouldn't you?
Of course.
Say, look at me, I caught that. Everybody, look at me, Emily Windsor.
Caught a bump ball, yes.
Every time you walk into bat here, you always get an applause, don't you? Do you notice that when you walk in with the Vipers?
Doesn't everyone?
Well, not all of them do, not as much as you do. Short, and it's hammered away, just wide of mid-on. Vince is running after it. Slides into that, but they'll pick up two more. They really are going hard at this, Essex, as we knew they would. And their last two defeats against Somerset and Kent, they have actually been bowled out in both innings for around the 184, 186 mark in the 20th. But it just shows, doesn't it? They go for it, and they'll go for it right the way down, even though they get bowled out. Unfortunately, on those occasions, they lost by 7 wickets in both games, including last night to Kent. Here's Ellis Bowles. Kushi again gives himself some room, and that's gone through the covers, 4 runs. Well, that's a good shot. He's given himself some room, allows him to free his arms, and he's picked the gap. And Hampshire, they've got a lot to think about here, because Essex are running away with this in these first few overs. 39 without loss, and we've had just 3.
Get John Turner back on, I think. His over went for 1 in that as well, that second over.
Incredible, isn't it?
They're just T20 cricket, isn't it? And I think this is what's amazing about T20 cricket, is about how sides go about it differently. You say Essex go so hard in the power play, they're coming at Hampshire. You don't necessarily see that with Hampshire when they play. They tend to, Ben McDermott and Vince, just build a little bit the first few overs, and then when they're in and they build a partnership, they cash in. But although it's only 20 overs, it can be played so differently. But Essex are on the charge here, 39 without loss. Into the fourth over as John Turner bowls, and that's outside the off stump. That's hit up and nearly hit the stump. For those that watched the Test match, that was nearly a Harry Brook dismissal off Nathan Lyon. The ball going up and bouncing back down, nearly hitting the stumps. But John Turner, so impressive here. He's bowled 7 deliveries, gone for 1 run.
And Ellis before him went for 17, and that's unusual for Ellis. And of course, the first over from Chris Wood went for 22.
Dan Lawrence is flying. He's on 21 off just 10 balls. As Turner in again bowls, and that's pushed between a backward a point and a gully, and that's 4 runs. That's a bit of class, that, from Dan Lawrence. Score moves to 43 without loss.
Well, it just goes to show, not only are Essex trying to bludgeon the ball away as well, but they're also using the pace. That was an intelligent shot, wasn't it? Just guided open the face, picked the gap. What a lovely shot. My word, he got 50-odd last night in their defeat to Kent. So he's in good form, Lance. Just checking with the umpire, I think, how many balls left? Should look at the scoreboard.
I think he actually asked the umpire to take his sunglasses off the head, because it's probably giving him a glare.
Ah.
Imagine they're John Turners. There's right arm over bowls, and that's pushed into the offside. They want a quick single. They hurry. Toby Albert there was just sat on the ring at cover, and rightly so, the way these Essex batters are playing. But 44 without loss then. Lawrence on 26 off 12. Kushi alongside him off on 16.
Well, Lawrence is striking at 216 per 100 at the moment. Kushi is about 140, I think that is. And Kushi, career-wise, strikes at 125, so he's well above. He's 160, Kushi.
Turner to Kushi, big swing. No ding. as they say. That's gone through to the keeper. That's good pace. And Turner is right on top of Cushy here.
He is, isn't he? Yeah, it's incredible, isn't it? You've got a guy only playing in his seventh T20 match. Only made his debut this year. He looks like Hampshire's main bowler already.
That he does, and when you're in form with a battle ball, you've got that confidence. As Turner in again, bowls and follows him, and that's a great shot off the back foot through the covers. Cushy's trying to give himself room to access that offside, and he punishes John Turner there. 48 without loss, Essex. Cushy on 20.
Well, I tell you what, they trust the wicket, the batters, don't they? And it looks a good wicket. It's coming on nicely, it's bouncing nicely. And this has the potential to be a high-scoring game. I mean, the hybrid wicket, sometimes you're never quite sure, are you, with the bounce and the pace it comes through. But this looks a goodie.
Turner bowls, and again, a big swing. It's a length delivery carrying high to Ben McDermott. Good pace by John Turner. That's four overs gone. 48 without loss, Essex.
Well, that was nine off that, which I suppose, actually, again, is pretty decent. I mean, they're going hard at it, especially Cushy. I mean, Cushy's just trying to thrash everything. And it is coming off because it's such a good wicket.
That is, and it's a beautiful evening as well. Barely a cloud in the sky. You can just see some planes overhead. Nice and high. Off to sunnier. Can you go to anywhere sunnier than here right now?
Where were you recently?
Menorca.
Was it sunnier there?
It was sunny.
Was it?
But I can't say it was sunnier because it was warm. But all I can say is I did have a nice cold swimming pool and unlimited drink. So.
Oh, perfect. 48 without loss, James Fuller takes over from that pavilion end and bowls. And it's hit up in the air by Lawrence. Just flicks that away, doesn't really get hold of it. Has that come off the pad? The umpire signalling leg bars. So Lawrence stays at 26. Essex move on to 49 without loss. This is a terrific start from the Essex team.
James Vince opting for Fuller in the power play here today. That extra pace that John Turner offers, James Fuller offers that as well. Chris Wood and Nathan Ellis, who aren't potentially as quick as these two, went the distance.
Comes in and bowls to Cushy. Cushy again glides that. He's finding the gap every time. And that's four behind square. Well, that's one thing, and that's another thing you notice with T20. It can be nights where you play shots and it goes straight to the fielders. Other nights you'll play and every shot you play misses the fielders. And that's exactly what's happening here.
Yeah, and it's interesting how Cushy's playing this extra pace this seam. He's not still at the crease. He is moving leg side of the ball to access this offside that's up in the circle. I'm interested here if James Vince is going to change the field. No, he's not, but I feel like if he is doing that, James Fuller has to follow him with this deep mid-wicket and deep square out.
50 up between these two, and that's come off 27 balls, as that's Fuller, and that's worked away on the onside. He hasn't quite got hold of it, but that is still going for four. Well, Cushy's just given himself plenty of room on the leg side, virtually every ball, just swinging through the line of the ball, and it's coming off. We saw this, Matt Carter did this for Sussex down at Hove the other night against Hampshire. They'd never really played much T20, had never opened, so they said, oh, you open, because you haven't been considered to be a T20 player before. And all he did was just chance his arm. I think Cushy's been a little bit better than that, but even so, 28 or 15 is putting Hampshire under massive pressure. Length ball, Cushy plays that out on the offside. Whiteley doesn't pick that up cleanly. Might have had a shot at the stumps had he done so. He'll come through for a single, and the Essex total moves on to 58 without loss. Great start from there.
Yeah, it certainly is, and I think the rest of this over and next over are going to be important to see which side finishes the better in the power play. I think when the field spreads here, the Ageas Bowl tends to be harder, so when we go into that seventh over and beyond.
Here's Fuller from that pavilion end and bowls. Lawrence goes down the leg side. He's appealing for a caught behind. It's not a call to wide, so it's obviously flicked something. I'm just looking at the batters to come in next for Essex. Michael Pepper, who did some serious damage against Hampshire at Chelmsford last year when Essex won that one. He's next in. He strikes at 144 career-wise. You've got Robin Das, who strikes at 152 career. Paul Water at 145. So there's some serious strikers still to come in the Essex side. 58 without loss. Here's Fuller. Bowles, who walks across his stumps and tries to whip that away on the leg side. Well, he does, but not with any power. And total moves on to 59 without loss. Well, that's 11 off that one, and it felt a quiet over.
Yeah, for sure, but I think Hampshire need to try and find a breakthrough here, because wickets in hand, off to a flyer, it bodes for hard work for Hampshire in this back end, but it looks a belter of a pitch.
It does look a belter, you're right. Yes, it does.
I'd want to be sat there with my pads on in the dressing room when you see that in the middle, that's for sure. And I can't imagine our bowlers would be too excited to get out there and bowl on this.
You really have got to mix it up here, haven't you, and just hope for the best. I mean, Nathan Ellis's first over went for 17, and he mixes it up pretty well, so even then that's not guaranteed.
Nathan Ellis then changes end and comes in from the hotel end to Lawrence Fall, and that's worked to mid on. James Vince comes around, throws in to the bowler's end, hits the stumps, but Dan Lawrence was way past it. 60 without loss, Essex. Lawrence is on 28 off 16. Cushy's had most of the strike for these previous few overs. But just a hum of the crowd. It's very packed here tonight, Kev.
It's a great crowd. It might even be a few more than what we've seen in the recent games here.
I'm sure these Hampshire fans know exactly how important this game is for both sides. Hampshire reigning champions. Want to get through this group stages, and these are important games. It's Ellis in, bowl shorter, that's pulled over mid on, and that's 6 runs. Wow, just swung his hands through that. Cushy, like he had a lot of time. Essex moves to 66 without loss, and Cushy on 35 off 17.
Well, if you're watching on the live picture feed, I mean, Cushy's just doing the same thing virtually every time, isn't he? Just stepping away to the leg side. And there's a lot of cross-batted shots, whether it's on the onside or the offside. He's just trying to hammer every ball. 35 off 17 for Rose Cushy.
Ellis skips and charges in. Fuller this time worked out to the deep square. Just rightly comes in and bounces it back into Ben McDermott at the crease. Tell you what, that's the size you want to field without the sun in your eyes, that's for sure. 67 without loss, Essex.
What do you reckon, Dawson? First over, oh no, we've got, first over out of the power play, so it's the last over of the power play. Would you put Dawson on there?
You've got to. The Seamers haven't been able to pick up a wicket, you've got to try something different. But it's going to be hard yards. Ellison, that's a quick bouncer, and that's going to be 4 more. He's pulled it. Beats a fine leg in the circle and a square leg out on the boundary. Wow, it's raining boundaries here in the Ageas Bowl.
I mean, this is your worst nightmare start, isn't it? I mean, when you're talking about, you know, in the field and how you want to start and how you want to do this and that in the field, this is actually your nightmare scenario, isn't it?
But let me go back to Surrey versus Middlesex yesterday. That opening stand was ridiculous. And Surrey, everyone thought, going to win. Really high scoring game against Middlesex, who hadn't even won a game. And they chased it down as Ellison bowls, and that's played back down the pitch. Quick single, Vince comes in, charges, throws at the keeper's end. They make that single comfortably. Lawrence on 33, 72 without loss, Essex.
So this was the Surrey opening stand?
Yeah, Surrey, massive opening stand, and they ended up with a huge total. I can't remember exactly.
About 250.
It was 250, just over 250. And then Middlesex chase it down. So that's where T20 cricket is these days. You see those huge scores and you see 72 off 6 overs and you think, wow. But the capability of these batters is incredible. It's Ellis in, bowls, slower delivery outside the off stump, given a wide by the umpire, Nathan Ellis, hands on head. But I think that was a wide, Kevin.
It looked it, didn't it? I mean, we weren't surprised the umpire called it. It looked like a slightly lower arm there from Nathan Ellis.
Probably going to his variations at this stage when you need to try something different. Cushy backing away as well, so I don't think it's a bad option to chase that wide line, but just didn't quite execute it. Ellis in, final ball of the over again, gives himself room, but pace off. Classic Nathan Ellis that. And that's the power play completed, 73 without loss, Essex. Challenging one for Hampshire, but that Essex dressing room will be very pleased.
It's a terrific start.
This is where Hampshire really need to pull it back. Field spreads, you are now allowed 5 outside the circle. It's a pretty even boundary today, pretty even, not huge boundaries, a bit of space either side behind the boundary rope because it's a massive playing surface here.
Doesn't look big enough at the moment. So Liam Dawson, who's having a pretty good season in this competition, he went for a few runs the other night against Gloucestershire, 2 overs, 1 for 29, but on the whole, he's been more than steady, and he's been charged by James Vince here to just try and change the tempo a little bit, because Essex are 73 off 6 overs, Lawrence is 33 off 18, facing this first ball from the left-arm spinner, round the wicket, Lawrence goes big, as he over mid-on, oh yes, that's low and flat, and that's two rows back, again up towards deep mid-on.
Sorry, I'm laughing. What do you do here as a bowler? Like, you're more of a bowler than me, Kim.
Well, you talk to Dawson, and he'll probably go very full now and just try and stop the batters getting underneath the bounce. He might not do it every ball, but I think he'll be starting to think that already, and that's only one ball. Here he comes in again. That's a length ball this time, a bit more outside off stump, but that's flicked away behind square. That ball is racing away, and that is four more. 10 off Dawson's first two balls.
And that, for me, was really, really skillful. Lawrence, he says let the ball come on, and there is a sweeper out on the cover boundary and a backward point in the circle, and he's just let it hit the bat. He's played it late, and Ross Whiteley had no chance out there to get round. His outfield's rapid, Kev.
Cool, isn't it just? I think that Arctic Monkeys concert has speeded up this outfield. I don't know why, I don't know how they've done it.
It's that seaweed. That
oh, the seaweed on it, yes. Dawson bowls, Lawrence just pushes that to Vince at extra cover. That's a dot ball. Crowd have actually, and Emily have clapped that. Hasn't been too many dot balls in this inning so far. It's 83 like without loss.
It's like a wicket ball, that.
Oh, it was, isn't it? Here's Dawson again from that pavilion end, and Lawrence just flicks that away on the leg side where there's a big gap. They run the first one. They may look for two. No, quickly in. I think that's Turner, is it? Coming in from deep mid wicket. Or is it Ellis? Might be Ellis, actually.
You're not taking on his arm.
No.
I think us Vipers females were in awe of Nathan Ellis's throw.
Really?
It's ridiculous.
That's why he does that boundary fielding, isn't he? 84 without loss. Coochie cuts that away, and again he's found the gap. Two fielders behind, square on the offside. There wasn't much of a gap between them, but somehow Coochie has found it.
Yeah, skillful again. And that real mix from this Essex batter. They've not just bolted the ball out the ground. There's been some skillful shots, some really good running between the wickets. Worrying signs for Hampshire so far.
Well, Coochie certainly looks a different player than the one that played against Hampshire at Chelmsford earlier in the season. He's 40 off 20. Both these batters have strike rates of 200 currently in this game. Coochie waits for it and just guides that behind point. This time it does find a fielder, but they still pick up a run. Token moves on to 90 without loss.
Expensive over, that one.
Is that right? 89? Oh, it's 89 without loss. Apologies. Don't think it really matters at the moment, the odd run.
You'll take one. But the crowd are enjoying what they're seeing. I think this is fantastic cricket from Essex so far. Have to have your sunglasses and hat on that side. And then as you look to the right, the shade, but both sides are equally full underneath us. Benny Howe into the attack for Hampshire. Skillful bowler, changes the pace. Right arm over. And this is first game at home, Kev. Benny Howe coming back from injury.
Yeah, he played at the Oval. He played at his old side, Gloucestershire.
He's howling, bowls, and that's pulled into the onside. Pace off. James Fuller comes round, and they're going to come back for two. Hit into a pocket by Coochie. Great running from Essex. The score will move to 91 without loss. Coochie to 43.
And played at Hove as well, so you're right, yeah. Fourth game after coming back from injury. And he's playing his first game here since he left in 2011.
Let's hope today's his day if you're a Hampshire supporter.
It used to be somebody's day for Hampshire.
Number seven on his back scurries in, and that's cut past the back quarter point. Will be a single. Coochie moves to 44 on the score. 92 without loss for Essex of 7.2 overs.
Yeah, his economy rate's been a bit high actually in the games that he's played. He's going at 10 and over. Career is only just over 7, so he has been expensive in the games that he's played.
Howling again. Probably a shorter run up compared to most other men's seamers bowls, and that's worked into the onside. James Fuller comes in from a long one and keeps it to a single. And I guess that's pretty hard, isn't it? Coming back into in the middle of a competition when you've had an injury, you sort of almost rush back as well. I'm sure he would have been one of Hampshire's white ball signings to get that rhythm, to get that confidence that you need in T20 cricket. So me personally, I'll let him off. I think he's a fantastic cricketer and a great signing for Hampshire, and let's hope today his confidence is building and he does a job. He's in bowls and that's cut, but straight to backward a point. Urbino run. Again, a round of applause for a dot ball.
Now, I think you're right, but there's only so long you can go at 10 and over. I mean, you're not going to hold your place if you're going through a whole group game, group campaign going at 10 and over.
I think we take 10 and over tonight, won't we?
Probably would, actually. Right. Yes. Well, 10 and over would be under the rate because it's over 12s at the moment.
Hal in from the hotel end again, and that's cut, and that's an outside edge. We talk about that luck, and that's four runs. Ben McDermott stood up to the stumps to Benny Howe. Kushi moves to 48, 97 without loss.
It's very fine, isn't it, really? I think he was trying to play it fine, but obviously not that fine, but I think the shot that he was trying to play was probably the right one, but yeah, nobody ever works it that fine. not intentionally.
But again, as a batter, you take them. 97 then, without loss, Essex. They're flying. As Howell in again bowls, and that's worked into the onside. They're running the first one hard. They're quick between the wickets. Dan Lawrence wants two, and they get back for two quite comfortably. That's fantastic running, fantastic batting, and that's Kushi's half century off just 26 balls. 7 fours, 2 sixes, as you heard the ground announcer Chris Temple there. What a start this is for Essex. 99 without loss, and Kev, the t-shirts in the crowd. Walkies going round. Mayhem over in that Colin Ingleby McKenzie stand.
They don't fire it from that gun anymore, do they? Because apparently health and safety, you can't do that anymore. So Harry the Hawk just throws them into the crowd. That happens around the country.
The Essex batters are firing it from the middle, though. You need heads up in the crowd there, the way these two are batting. There's a lot of conversations between James Vince and James Fuller now, that who's going to bowl the next over, about where to go, where they're going to get this breakthrough, which is vitally important for Hampshire now on this stage. 8 overs gone, 99 without loss.
Yeah, well, with every over that goes past, Essex's innings is heading towards 200 plus. Unless Hampshire can find a way here, just not only breaking this partnership up, but as I mentioned earlier, there's some really big hitters to come as well. So Essex are really in the box seat here. 12 overs remain. That feels a lot with the way that they're scoring. Here's Fuller then from the pavilion end, and that's hammered away on the leg side. And as he found the gap, he has down towards the tunnel over that reseeded area.
Tell you what, that was a misfield from the groundsman as well. That threw his legs, didn't want it, Kev.
Probably wasn't sure how he was going to react off that reseeded area.
But that's one of those where that side, as I said, the sun's in your eyes, and not saying that Joe Weatherly's at deep square there would have got there. That was placed beautifully by Dan Lawrence, but you pick it up late. Yeah. You don't see that ball coming, so it is challenging out on that rope at the moment.
100 up for Essex, 103 without loss at the start of the ninth. Here's Fuller, bowls to Lawrence, gives himself some room, works that up, nearly takes Kushi out with it as it works its way up towards the pavilion, and that'll be a half century there for Lawrence. And that is equally well played, and that 50 has come off 25 deliveries. Kushi, his half century earlier, was his third of this campaign, and for Lawrence, exactly the same. Both have passed 50 for the third time in this competition this season.
They've both looked unfazed tonight, I think.
Well, they've hardly made a mistake, have they? Second half century in a row for Dan Lawrence. As Fuller comes in, a bowl to Kushi this time. And Kushi works it away on the onside. It'll be a single as it goes out to mid-wicket. 105 without loss. Six runs off the first three balls of this over. Hampshire just don't have an answer at the moment to this Essex pair.
Essex, a good side last year as well, weren't they? They qualified, finished third in the group above Hampshire. They had 19 points. Hampshire finished on 18. Hampshire obviously went on to go and win. Essex lost in the quarter-finals. against Lancashire, so they want to go one better this year.
That's for sure. Goes across his stumps and somehow works that away on the leg side. Now, I don't think I've quite seen a shot like that. Emily might describe it better than I'm going to even attempt to do, as it picks up two runs. What is that?
Well, it looked like he was going for a Joe Root ramp over the offside. James Fuller followed him, and he's almost just chipped it up in the air. Isn't it? It's like a volleyball serve.
Yeah, it's weird, isn't it?
Sort of a volleyball jab.
Yeah, very weird. Brings two runs, though. Might see that again. If it's brought you two runs. Mind you, that's not enough the way these two are playing. Here's Fuller again, and that's hammered away. That's six runs. That was always six from the moment it left his bat, and that's about seven or eight rows back, just to the left of the tunnel. He was well in control of that shot. It was almost telegraphed, that ball from Fuller.
Yeah, that was an ouch in the crowd as well. That was hit hard and flat. I don't think I've seen this many sixes at this crowd before, Kev. This is some impressive hitting from these two, Dan Lawrence and Cushy. Going really, really well, Essex.
Wow.
And I just don't know where Hampshire should bowl. I think potentially Benny Howe, with his pace off deliveries in the previous over, looked harder to hit than James Fuller, the boundary coming off an outside edge.
He's gone for 24. This is the last ball of his second, and that's driven past a diving Fuller, only up to mid-off though. So he's gone for 25 off two. Again, I don't think he'll be bowling out the way things are going. And Essex are 114 without loss off the first nine overs. Remember, Hampshire, they reckon, need to win two of their last three to qualify. It'll probably be another away tie if they do. But of course, if you lose this, then it definitely means you need to win your last two, which again, as we know from the previous 2 years, it's fine because Hampshire have done it, but
that's how they roll, Kev.
Yeah, they do.
But look, I think this is a type of pitch where there's no demons in it. The batters are confident with how they're going so far. They can put their hands through it. And you're almost, as a fielding side, waiting for the batters to make a mistake. Yeah. And so far, both Lawrence and Cushy haven't looked like making a mistake at all.
They haven't. There's been no chances. There's been hardly any miss hits. There's been nothing that's gone near a fielder. It's about as good a 114-run opening stand as you'd see.
Nine overs gone then. Liam Dawson changing ends from their hotel end, left arm, and that's bowled. That's hit hard down the ground. There's a fielder at mid-on who dives. James Fuller, one of the better fielders in this Hampshire team, can't get there. And Lawrence will move to 63, 118 without loss.
Wow. Well, it was a full toss. Lawrence used his feet. A couple of paces made the full toss probably a little higher. I think it might have just been. But that's an example of, I think, Dawson's going to bowl full here on the whole.
Full and quick under the bat as he's in bowls, and that is slower. That's hit hard down the ground. James Fuller can't get there, and he's chipped that for six, Kev. Didn't look like he got hold of that one. I was thinking the long on fielder was in with a chance, but no, he wasn't. 124 without loss off 9.2 overs.
I mean, it's great to watch, isn't it? I mean, this is a first-class exhibition of how to hit hard in T20, but the longer
from Ben McDermott, that signalled a wide.
Top take there.
125 without loss.
Always difficult when it's full down the next side, isn't it? Took it easy.
Dawson bowls, and that's outside the off stump, a play and miss. A rare play and miss, and half appeal by Ben McDermott, but Dawson wasn't interested. 125 without loss.
I think Cushy played and missed a couple of times at Turner, trying to swish him away. That's only about the third play and miss.
Dawson in again, gives himself room and drives out to the cover sweeper. Will just be a single. Nathan Ellis fires it into the deck. Soften that ball up. 126 without loss, and the sun beaming down. Crowd enjoying all forms of beverages below us as Dawson in again bowls, and that's heaved down the ground. Mistimed this time by Cushy. Will just be a single. He moves to 52, 127 without loss.
Well, you're right, Emily. I mean, the pitch is a goodie, isn't it? You can see that. The ball's done nothing but hit the middle of the bat, really.
Dawson bowls, advances, misses and stumped. Lawrence has gone for an almighty heave. If he got hold of that, that was going to Winchester. Dan Lawrence has gone for a very impressive 70 off 33 deliveries. And that's the first breakthrough for Hampshire. A much needed one, that's for sure. The score 127 for one.
Well, I tell you what, Emily, there's a couple of things in that dismissal. One is Dawson, brilliant, threw it out wide. He may just have seen Lawrence come down the wicket very late and just threw it out wide. The other thing as well is that looked like that turned a bit. Now, I know that's from fairly wide, and we haven't seen one turn from straight, which is sort of okay. But I think at 127 for one, the way Essex have played, I don't think you want to see too many balls starting to turn tonight. That's for sure. But well bowled, Liam Dawson. Again, just thinking, isn't it? Trying to outguess the batter. And maybe just having half an eye on, is he going to move? Is he going to come down the wicket at me? And maybe just be prepared that right at the last minute you just change your line. And that's exactly what he's done there. But a terrific opening start, opening partnership there for Essex.
Yeah, skillful from Liam Dawson, the experienced T20 campaigner for Hampshire. He knows this ground well, but someone needed to hold their hand up, and Liam Dawson's done that. Fantastic breakthrough, but what an innings from Dan Lawrence. Such a pleasure to watch and see that. 70 off 33 deliveries. Wow.
212 runs per 100 balls, that equivalent strike rate. That is terrific. Is it me? I can't remember. It's Chris Wood back into the attack, and that's cut out into the deep where James Fuller is doing the boundary fields away to our right. And Cushy moves on to 53. Now, this is another dangerous player here in Michael Pepper, the 24-year-old, playing his 51st T20 match tonight. He strikes at 144 career. Those of you that may have listened to the game at Chelmsford last year absolutely destroyed Hampshire in a run chase. And Essex really did, just got over the line in no time at all. He's striking at 171 this season. As that's just pushed away out on the offside by Pepper, who's got a white towel hanging out at the back of his trousers. I don't think I've seen a batter have that. I've seen bowlers, I've seen fielders. Have you seen that from a batter?
No, never, and that's quite unique. I tell you what, if I was Cushy, I'd be like, can you make sure your bum's to the crowd, please? Because you don't want a white towel, do you, in the line of your sight?
You don't want, you don't want the sun shining off it. 129 for one, it is Cushy facing, who's on 53. Cushy gets a low full toss and does well to reach that and drives it wide of mid on. Dawson fields. And that will be two runs to Feroz Cushy, who moves on to 55. And he's striking at 183 currently. These batters really are going hard at it here. 131 for one. They trust the surface. The pace of the surface is good. The bounce of the surface is good. It's very true. And the batters really are just gorging themselves in the conditions. Wood over the wicket again. Bowls. Cushy smacks that. You can hear that hard. One bounce up to mid on. Probably at the bottom of the bat, actually, because that was a fairly full delivery from Chris Wood, who's coming towards the end of his second over, number 26.
I want to add something in that as well. The outfield is lightning.
Yeah.
I think everything's in favour of the batters at the moment, that's for sure.
Let's just wait until Hampshire bat.
They might so be under negative, so
much.
Care.
Well, I'm not, but they'll be under so much pressure the way Essex are going, aren't they? They've got to go at it straight away. That's cut away by Pepper out into the deep at point. They should run two. No, Fuller does well. Keeps that down to a single. Does very, very well indeed. Quite right. The crowd have given him some applause for that because it was on his wrong side, his left-hand side.
Yeah, great bit of work out there. He's got a bullet arm as well. I think, as I said earlier, Hampshire really pride themselves on their fielding, and I know head coach A.D. Birrell there's a lot with them on that, and it does make a difference in T20 cricket. It makes a difference in all cricket, but even more so in the short format.
Cushy drives through extra cover. Chase is on for Fuller. He's gone running to the shadows into the straw-coloured area of the outfield.
You can see
the dust coming up the sand. Yes. It did look like that when the dust was coming up, didn't it?
Do you know what that looked like when the dust come up? Is I'd love to have seen James Fuller give it the run and then, do you know, long jump when he landed the sand. But saying that, I'm not saying anything. When I saw the grounds as they were peeling away that stage, for it to look like this, credit to the groundsmen. I dread to think the hours they've put in. Well, in fact, I know the hours. It's ridiculous. But what a fantastic night for the club that was, I'm sure.
It was 30,000 here for the Arctic Monkeys, wasn't it? And yeah, I have to say, the outfield has recovered a lot in the last week. I did get messaged about the state of the outfield when they pulled all the boarding up. Apparently it looked a bit of a mess, but they've done a great job over the last week.
Liam Dawson's to continue then. Quite a unique field for a left-arm spinner. There's a very backward a point out on the boundary. There's Dawson in, bowls, and that's outside the off stump. That's hit straight down the ground. Mid-on's inside the circle to compensate for that fielder, and that's four runs to Kushi. Into Pepper, sorry. He moves to six, 139 for one.
I was talking to Simon earlier, the grounds person, and he said that as long as there's no concert during the Ashes Test match year of 2027, he said don't have a concert there.
That rings a change of field then. The backward a point fielder comes into the circle, and Ross Whiteley comes out to a long on. There's Dawson into Pepper, bowls, and that's hit to extra cover. That's a fantastic diving stop by James Vince. Captain setting the standards for Hampshire. A good bit of work from him. Dawson from this hotel end continues to Pepper. Gone for a reverse sweep, and that's gone past backward a point. Nathan Ellis at deep backward point comes in through, comes in quickly, an appeal for a run out. But Pepper quick in the end. If there's one arm I'm not taking on, it's Nathan Ellis's. But they do well. Pepper to 8, 141 for one.
Vince has got the double teapot on again. He was still appealing long after the other appeals had stopped. I think he's not in a bad position to have judged that. Squarish cover. He seems to think that was a bit close. He's now asking Ellis what he thought. He was throwing in from fairly square. I'm just looking at the queue for the food away to our left. What's that called? The Greek souvenir, some Greek something or other. Long queue for that. Obviously some good food. What's that? I can't read it.
My eyes can't read that either, especially with the sun beaming into this commentary box. There's a lot of food outlets here on that gantry. It's Dawson, left arm round in, bowls, and that's hit through the offside. Nathan Ellis has to do the work again. They're going to run two. He fires it into the bowler's end, and they come back for two. Great running from Essex. Just hitting it to Nathan Ellis's left or right, hitting the pockets. Scoring freely at the moment. Essex 143 for one. Pepper on 10 off six deliveries. As Dawson approaches and then pulls out. Wasn't going for a man cat. He poises again from this hotel end. Bowls and advances, hits down the pitch. Fielded at long on. Just be a single. Good over this from Liam Dawson. So far, one ball remains, 144 for one.
Yeah, I mean, he's gone for a few runs, but actually, he's still bowling very intelligently.
All the fielders out, straight, cover, long off, long on, deep mid-wicket and deep square legs. Dawson in, fires that, that's hit straight. And that comes round Ross Whiteley, the left-hander. They think about two, but a great bit of work and applauded from Ian Dawson. Good over that from him. 145 for one then. 12 overs gone. So 8 over remain. What do you reckon here? What will Hampshire be happy with? Bear in mind the start they got up to. What score are they looking?
You've got to be expecting 200 now, haven't you? I think you'll just be thinking, let's keep it to as lower end 200s as possible. I mean, this could very easily get out of hand. I mean, even though that over of 10 from Ian Dawson, your spinner in this situation, one wicket down, Essex going well, you'd be looking to take spinners apart. So I think at the end of the day, 10 off that over is not a bad return. Even though Dawson has bowled 3 overs, 1 for 39. It's souvlaki, which I've never heard of before. Greek souvlaki, and apparently it's a popular fast food choice in Greece. Skewers of marinated meat cooked over an open fire, lamb, pork or chicken. I never heard that before. Souvlaki, have you?
No.
I mean, you've only heard of southern fried chicken, haven't you, really, and donuts.
The Italians, me. I've only heard of spaghetti bolognese. No, fish and chips. I'll tell you what, the double-decker fish and chips van that's been here all year, it's open. The queue's not massive. That blue and white van, it's never open for the championship game, but it stands out, but certainly open tonight with this big crowd. It's Benny Howe from the pavilion end bowls, and that's pushed to the offside.
146 for one. I think the queue currently it goes to the Greek souvlaki store because that's got the longest queue. Just to the right of that, the bar area, well, that's not surprising. That's got a fairly long queue as well. But nice. There are a lot of people here tonight.
A nice mix of ages when I was driving in this evening. Some older members, some real young people here as well. Male, female, it's a mixture of a crowd.
Here's Benny Howe over the wicket, and that's a driven hard wide and mid off by Pepper. This should be at least two, and it might even be four. It is, it's beating the fielder out there in the deep. Liam Dawson couldn't quite get there. Again, just emphasises that the field is very quick here tonight. They have actually cut it quite a bit here to try and get it all even and back to somewhere near where they wanted to after that concert.
150 up.
Moaning to death here. 150 in the 13th. Four balls left of it. Benny Howe has gone for 15 from eight deliveries. Essex. That one wicket to fall. Darren Lawrence, 70 off 30 balls. That's the only wicket that's fallen so far. Reverse sweep there from Pepper. That's going for four. Well, I did say he was a dangerous player, and he's proving it here straight away.
Yeah, fantastic shot. Just manipulating the field. And I'm guessing that's why Hampshire started with that deep backward a point, is the fact that Pepper can play that reverse sweep so well, and it's just an easy boundary option for him if you can play that destructive.
Certainly is. Benny Howe was just about to start his run up there and stopped, and he's walking back. 19 already, Michael Pepper. That's off just nine balls. Feroz Kushi, who opened up 60 off 34 at the non-striker's end. Here's Howe. Gives himself some room there, Pepper. Follows him a little bit, Howe. They want a single. Howe comes around on the leg side to the field.
Just had
that
a
is a top ball.
It's a top ball. I've just had a message from the Southern Vipers captain, Georgia Adams.
Yes.
She's tearing us apart, Kev. She said, you two haven't lived if you've not eaten a souvlaki. Come on now. Especially the Ageas Bowl one. It's banging.
Is that Georgia? She That's obviously Georgia. Is a big lover of Greek food.
And especially this one.
Of the souvlaki. That's right. I never had Georgia Adams down as a souvlaki fan.
Georgia Adams.
Apparently I was wrong.
She's going to hate me for saying this. Just loves food.
Does she really? Have you told your captain that you brought donuts up? Is that trying to hammer away? He's bowled. Leg stump out of the ground. Full delivery. Pepper trying to smack that away on the leg side. And he goes for 19. It's 154 for two.
Yeah, big wicket for Hampshire. Towards this back end of T20, every wicket just slows that run rate down. And Pepper was just starting to go there. First home wicket of the season for Benny Howe. And he enjoyed that one. 154 for two Essex, and they're just pulling them back slightly after that fantastic start.
That was 19 off 11 deliveries there for Pepper. And this is Paul Walter, who again can strike a mean ball. 145 runs per 100 is his normal strike rate, but this year he's currently striking at 167. So another dangerous player walks to the middle.
Do you know what I've forgotten, Kim? Is how much you love strike rates in T20 cricket.
Do I go over the top with that?
No, it's a great bit of information.
Is it?
I now know every Essex bat's strike rate. Can I remember it?
No.
Correct.
It doesn't matter about the ones that are out. You don't need to worry about them anymore. They're gone.
Okay, I'll just try and remember Paul Waters. But hopefully today for Hampshire, he won't be striking at that. But it's a pitch that you can, that's for sure.
Left-hander is Paul Walter, so Benny Howe comes round the wicket from that pavilion end. Bowls. It's flicked away in the air, but safe. Down towards deep square leg. He should get two runs for that. As Ross Whiteley comes around from deep square leg. That is the end of the 13th over, with Essex having been put into bat. 156 for two. So one wicket in that over, but still Howell went for 11. Oh, and Robbie James on the screen is actually at one of the outlets. Sorry, yes.
How tall is Paul Walter?
How tall?
He is.
He is, isn't he?
Wow, I actually, surely that's on his Wikipedia for someone of his height. This is a fact that I need to find out, because stood next to anyone, James Vince is quite a tall player. He looks like a...
Have a look. See if you can have a look.
I'm going to find
Unless
out.
Unless you want me to, I can help you out. Still a long queue for the souvlaki.
Georgia Adams probably in that after...
Do you reckon she'll be there?
If you ever want to find Georgia Adams for an autograph, listeners, that's the queue to go to in a T20 blast.
Souvlaki and a Georgia Adams autograph. It's a perfect combination.
It's exactly what you want. There's John Turner into the attack. Takushi gives himself room and that's... John Turner, he'll take that.
What are we having your donuts, by the way?
It's going to have to be a quick half-time snack, isn't it?
This isn't it, really. Are you training tomorrow?
No.
It's this as well, isn't it, really?
Actually, I am going to come in and gym.
See, if Georgia knew that you'd had a couple of donuts before your training, she'd make you work extra hard.
Turner in, and that's quick delivery, worked onto the onside. He's going to have to chase after it at mid-wicket. He does well. He moves to one, Kushi to 61 on 5-7 for two. It's all about balance, Kev.
Yeah.
I'm sure Georgia, if she was up here as well, would join us for a donut.
Would she?
But I do have the facts of how tall Paul Water is.
Yes.
Because he stands there at the crease now. How tall do you reckon?
6'4".
Way off, Kev.
Really?
6'8".
Wow, that's Chris Tremlett territory.
All 6'8" of the left-handed Paul Water is at the crease. He's looking around at where his gaps are. But with those levers, he's going to be aiming for the crowd, that's for sure. His right arm over, Turner in, bowls, and that's an inside edge. And it's not gone into the crowd, it's just gone two strips over. But they come through for a quick single. Paul Water is on 3 off 2 deliveries. Essex, 158 for two.
So as well as those donuts, where are you going to find room for those chocolate eclairs you were talking about?
Now you're stitching me up. I've not got any chocolate eclairs, can confirm that. There's Turner in, bowls, and he bowled him! Stumps out the ground. And if that is a send-off, Kevin James, John Turner enjoyed that one. Kushi's gone for a very well played 61 off 37 deliveries. Off stump out the ground, doesn't get much better than that. Hampshire pulling it back here after a fantastic start from Essex.
Yeah, it is slowly but surely, isn't it? The run rate isn't increasing, it's slowly decreasing, so that's good news. Just gave himself some room again, didn't he? And whereas he'd had a lot of success early on in his innings. In fact, it didn't feel as though he's been facing a lot of the bowling over the last few overs. Just felt that once Dan Lawrence had gone, that perhaps maybe his fluidity was starting to sort of disappear as well. And he'd scored a lot of runs, giving himself some room. But John Turner proving once more just what a find he's been. Now, Daniel Sams, the Australian, comes to the crease. I won't mention his strike rate because you don't like me mentioning strike rates.
No, I need to know now.
Well,
do you know what? I could beat you to it.
Go on. I'll let you do it. I'll let you...
Striking at 167.
This season, which again is an improvement on his 152 career. So some of these Essex boys, I mean, they really are going hard at it this year with success.
Right-handed Sams then faces up to Turner. He bowls quick on his pads. Worked out to a fine leg for a single. But Sams is off the mark then, first delivery.
I think it was last night, Chris Temple doing the stadium announcing here. I think it was last night he said that Daniel Sams hit one of the biggest sixes of this season's competition.
Listen to that crowd, Kev.
It's great when they're joining in, isn't it?
Turner to Walter, and that's again hit him. Quick this from John Turner. Just be a single from Walter. That's a fantastic over from John Turner, and that's applauded. He's bowled his 3 overs for just 14 runs so far. And that important wicket of Kushi. 160 for 3 then, Essex off 14 overs. 6 overs remain.
Well, yeah, 4 runs off that as well. I mean, this is terrific stuff. We're talking about a guy that had never played T20 cricket first team until this season. And he's actually become one of Hampshire's main strike bowlers in the space of, well, he's in his 27th, but it was before tonight. He's a really, really important part of Hampshire's T20 team.
Yeah, he is, and I guess that's unfortunate for Mason Crane as well, because previously probably he'd be the name that would come out and you'd see Mason Crane in the side, the leg spinner, especially at home. But John Turner is saying, you can't drop me, Skipper, you can't drop me, A.D. Birrell.
Chris Woods round the wicket with his left arm seamers to the left-hander Paul Walter. It's full outside the off stump. Walter gets a bat on it. The ball flicks away on the offside, and that will be just a single. Walter moves on to five. 161 for three. The wickets that have fallen. Dan Lawrence in the 10th. 127 for one. 70 off 30 balls. Michael Pepper in the 13th. 19 off 11. That's 154 for two. Feroz Kushi in the 14th. Bolt Turner, 61 off 37 balls. 158 for three. Which is just affecting the tempo, just enough. That run rate is about 11.5, but it has dipped, hasn't it?
Yeah, it definitely has. And so I think James Vince and Hampshire will be happy with how they're going. But these last 5.5 overs are vitally important, and it's that momentum going into the next innings. T20 cricket, yeah. Momentum carries through, and it's really important. And John Turner, after bowling that fantastic over, he's got a run some hard yards here to get the right field for Chris Wood.
He's gone out to point. He's gone out backward point. He's in front. Now he's backward. Now he's in front.
He's doing the hokey-cokey.
He is, yeah. Moving well as Chris Wood bowls. Sam's misses that cut shot. Goes through to keeper Ben McDermott. You're right, and these next five and a bit overs are very important, because if Hampshire can maintain this stifling a little bit and squeezing of the run rate, then they will go in feeling, do you know what, we could have been chasing an awful lot more, so we've done well. So the challenge now is for Essex actually just to pull away again if they can. That's smashed away by Sams out towards extra cover, not timed. Goes out to Ross Whiteley though, who's fielding in a bit of a desert out there.
The sandpit is what we're going to call
it. That's right. It's just an area way to our right at extra cover for the right-handers. Deep mid-wicket for Walter, where it's a bit more of a sand pit than one or two other areas. But as we say, this outfield has recovered pretty well from the concert as Wood comes in again. Walter tries to swing, misses. Wood misses the fielding on his follow-through. Walter picks up a single.
Yeah, you can see here the hard yards Hampshire do off the field into the game. You can see they've clearly got different plans for different batters. And here Chris Wood coming left arm over the wicket to Paul Walter, the left-hander, so angling it across him at the wide line, with two fielders out, not bowling into his arc. And I guess that's the impressive work from Stato as well.
Over the wicket to Sam, swings, gets an inside edge, runs down to fine leg. I think that's Toby Albert going after that. Picks it up, pulls it back, and Sam's will pick up two. Just misfields a little bit as he picks it up again. That throws over McDermott. Fortunately, John Turner is backing up. Sam's moves on to 4 of 4, 165 for three, and we have one ball left at the 15th.
Yeah, Joe Maiden.
Oh, it's Joe Maiden,
the Hampshire, no, the Hampshire analyst is very impressive. I think he's done some Pakistan Super League, so he's very experienced now.
Oh, I thought you said Joe Maiden was out there for a minute. Sam swings that away, and he goes out towards deep backward point. But Joe Weatherly fields. Haven't mentioned his name so much in the field this evening. He's been hiding a little bit. 15 gone. 5 to do. Essex still in a very good position here at 166 for 3, but the run rate has dipped a little bit. Only 10 runs off the last two overs.
Yeah, well, and I think that's credit to these Hampshire bowlers, and I think they've done it well in this competition, actually, is bowling at the death. And I think we haven't Nathan Ellis, who's probably the best Hampshire bowler at the death. He's still got a couple of overs left, and he'll be vitally important, and he's won. Incredibly hard to get away, so I think James Vince is lucky. That said, his death bowlers, he's got a lot of them up his sleeve. As John Turner charging in again, bowls full, and that's driven to Liam Dawson, who misfields at extra cover. He's charged in. James Vince does well in another sandpit on the other side, and they're going to come back for three. But Liam Dawson holds his hand up to John Turner there.
Well, he's on the square there, Liam Dawson, so that's not the outfield. Right on the edge of the square, and it's a cut wicket. Maybe there's a few bowlers' footmarks there. It'd be a practice wicket more than anything, but it doesn't seem to be an obvious bad bounce.
Turner into the left-handed Paul Walter. Gone for a ramp, and that's through to Ben McDermott. I'm glad that. that wasn't signalled wide. It did miss the leg stump, but he's given himself a lot of room there.
It's bomb, isn't it?
John Turner is running back to his mark, so I think that cut-off point could be under threat.
17 minutes past.
Hampshire fell to that, didn't they, at Surrey. Turner in again, bowl short, that's high up in the air. There's no one at fine leg, so it's going to land safe. It's a bit of chipping. He'll come back for two. Paul Water moves to 8 of 7 deliveries. 171 for 3 Essex, 4.3 over. These two just haven't been able to get hold of it like we saw Lawrence and Bushy.
I agree. And Walter has been a bit of a mixture, hasn't he? He's been batting like Ross Whiteley did up until the Gloucestershire game, swinging away and it's come off the glove, anything but the middle of the bat.
Turner in again, that's hit hard to captain James Vince, taken. John Turner, what an evening he's had. He's now picked up his second. Paul Walter's gone for 8 off 8 deliveries. 171 for 4 now, Essex.
Well, that's probably the first one that's come anywhere near out the middle of the bat there for Paul Water. It's just hit flat and hard to extra cover, mid off. Vince staying behind that. Just falling to his knees as he took the catch.
And I tell you what, James Vince signalled to his fielders to just stay. And that again is because they're going to be close to that cut off point.
They've got 11 minutes and we have two balls left of the 16th over, so it's going to be tight. Matt Critchley is the new batter for Essex. And he strikes career 120, and he's about 120 this season, so he's probably the first player that's come in that actually is playing pretty much to his career runs, playing his 110th T20 this evening, played a lot of those for Derbyshire.
Do you know what, going back to the time, I feel like you should get extra time when it's belted into the crowd.
You'd think so, wouldn't you?
Turner in, bowls, that's hit him on the pad, appealing for LBW, given! That finger went up quickly. John Turner's fired up here at the Ageas Bowl. That's his third. Matt Critchley's gone for the Golden Duck. And got to walk back to the crease. LBW to John Turner.
You know what that means, don't you?
We're dancing in the moonlight.
Well, apart from that, he's on a hat-trick. John Turner is on a hat-trick here. And he's got one ball, so that's perfect. So he needs to make this one count. Here, the crowd will get behind him here, that's sure. Chris Temple, the stadium announcer, he doesn't miss a trick. Ball will help the crowd get behind him. There you go.
Will Butterman comes to the crease. The crowd are alive. John Turner's alive. He's ready. He's charging in. Bowls, and that's played down onto the bit. Turner's literally next to the batter. John Turner, enjoy that applause. Four overs, 19 runs, 3 wickets in a high scoring T20. Impressive from a young fast bowler.
You know, he's impressed on a number of occasions in this year's tournament, but that's probably just about the standout. You know, when batters are going hard at you from the start, or was it his second over? When the first over from Chris Wood went for 21, there was a big over after that as well from Nathan Ellis. And to come out of that with 19 runs from your four overs, that is absolutely top class stuff.
And that over there, he's just bowled, Kev, that's game changing. Just 5 runs from it in the 16th over and picked up 2 wickets. Every wicket stems the run flow. There's a Mexican waves being start below. What an atmosphere there. Here, Kev, this is probably the best I've seen.
This is the best crowd of the season, and we've had some good ones. Now, here's Nathan Ellis. Unusually, he's gone for 31 off 2 overs, outside off stump, and that's cracked away by Sams. In fact, I think he just spent more time just trying to reach the ball rather than anything. Didn't try and hit it too hard in the end. Sams moves on to 9, Buttonman on strike, and Essex 172 for 5. Yeah, that run rate has slowly been coming down, isn't it? It was over 12 a little while ago, it was then over. Now it's down to just over 10 and a half. Small margins, but it means is that Essex have never really been able to capitalise on that 127 opening stand between Lawrence and Cushy, who got them away to a great start when Lawrence was out in the 10th over. They were really putting Hampshire to the sword, but slowly but surely they've come back, chiefly through John Turner. Terrific spell from him, 3 for 19. Here's Nathan Ellis, crowd getting behind Ellis here, who's bowling to Buttleman. Buttleman goes for a little scoop, hits it in the air, and that could be out. Liam Dawson. Well, Buttleman got himself in a bit of trouble there. He was going to try and play a little scoop down the leg side. The ball was too full, it was outside off stump, and in the end, he's just scooped it out to Dawson at point. And Buttleman goes for no score. And again, this Essex innings is really stuttering here.
Yeah, and I think this is credit to the Hampshire bowlers, but also from an Essex point of view, I felt like both Lawrence and Cushy, they weren't reckless. They weren't. You didn't see them playing too many ramps. You didn't see them over hitting the ball. They were just hitting the space that's available here at the Ageas Bowl. And when it was in their area, they hit through it. And this middle order of Essex, they're just almost trying to be too quirky. And I think, I hope the Hampshire batters that are in this field now watching on stick to the tactic both Lawrence and Cushy and Pepper played, as opposed to trying to do too much.
Well, at one stage we thought maybe 230, 240, might even a few more if they'd really put a late burst on top of the early burst they put on. But I mean, yeah, I think Hampshire might be thinking, do you know what, we'll get them for under 200 here. And it might be well under 200 here. Simon Harmer, the captain, is the new batter. Now we're starting to get into the lower order. Hampshire might be able to make even more headwind here as Harmer gets one down the leg side. That'll be called a wide. He's gone for the leg stump Yorker there, and Nathan Ellis either thinks that he's hit him on the pad, or he's saying that's too close to leg stump to be called a wide. The umpire is saying to him, no, that's well outside leg stump. I don't think it's well outside leg stump.
I felt like that went through him as well. It's one of those, I'm not sure that's what Nathan Ellis is saying, but the umpire's decision's final. Keep your mouth shut, Nathan Ellis. You don't want to be getting called to the umpire's room after.
The cutoff has been extended to 2018, so that's 6 minutes away. And we are still four balls to bowl in the 17th. Harmer gets a slower ball, just works that into the offside behind square. Does well, actually, Harmer, just waits for it. And he's off the mark. 174 for six. Really, Hampshire have got to hurry through this. Don't want to be penalised with fielders coming up on the 30-yard circle, which is what happens now. That's the new rules now, where the fielder has to come up inside the 30-yard circle for every hour that you fail to bowl before the cut-off point. 74 for six. Daniel Sams has been fairly quiet so far, facing Ellis, and he's gone big this time, and that's going to be called to deep mid. Oh no, just palmed over. It was just a little too high for the field. Not sure who is. Is the umpire signalled four?
James Fuller there, I think.
The umpire hasn't signalled four, though, has he? I probably got that wrong. It's definitely six. No full toss in the end. Yeah, it was six. Yeah, in the end, it was just too close to the boundary, really, to be able to do much with that. Six off Nathan Ellis. He's gone for a few tonight. Very unusual for him. 180 for six. Comes in and bowls to Sams once more. And Sams gets a short ball and he cuts it there. It's half fielded at backward a point. I think that's enough pace taken off the ball. Yes, just. Turner, who else? Drags that ball back from the rope. I think that was Liam Dawson that took the pace off it initially. It was. And Sams, I think, picked up three there. Moves on to 18. But that's off nine. He's striking at two a ball. He's warming up, Sams. At 183 for six with one ball left of the 17th.
Yeah, Hampshire. I want to see him back in the pavilion. That's for sure. Hampshire crowd. Right into the cricket here, Kev. They're all
terrific, isn't
on their seats.
There's a lot of people here tonight. As Ellis comes in and bowls. Harmer gets wrapped on the back. Looks out. Yes, it is. Not much doubt about that. Harmer on the crease. Ball strikes him in front. And that is Ellis's second wicket of the evening. Harmer goes for one. And he faced just two deliveries.
Yeah, good bowling from Ellis. Fantastic at the death for Hampshire. These regular wickets are really helpful at this stage, that's for sure. James Vince giving James Fuller the nod for the 18th over from the tail end. Fielders are already in place before the batters are even at the crease.
Do you know what? Essex have lost four wickets for 12 runs, having put on 127 and 10 overs for the first wicket. They were then 152 for 2 in the 13th, 158 for 3 in the 14th, and from the 16th over onwards, that's where the wickets have fallen regularly.
Yeah, credit to Hampshire for how they've come back, as James Fuller is ready from this hotel end, bowls to Sam, and that's hit hard down the ground, that's hit Robin Dass's bat, and they're going to come through for one. I think James Vince is saying, are you going to run that? He's going to wind him up here, but it was going to be a one anyway.
Yeah.
To be honest, I think it was hit quite hard, so saved John Turner running some yards.
I think Sam's actually signalled to Vince that it would have been one anyway, so we'll run it.
The sun really at an awkward height now, just setting to our right. Still nice and high, and honestly not a cloud in the sky. It's Fuller in right arm over, full Yorker length, and that's defended into the offside by Dass. He'd be off the mark. Score moves 185 to 7.
I'll tell you what, Dass, he's another dangerous player. Career 150, strike rate 160 this season. I know I'm boring you. I hope I'm not boring the listeners and the watchers as much as I'm boring you with those stats.
I reckon I have to give Kev a new project. 26 on his back, fluorescent yellow shirt, bowls and play a miss by Sams. If he got hold of that, that was going a long way. He's on to 19 off 11 deliveries, 185 for 7.
You can tweet Emily at Ims Windsor if you think those stats are particularly boring. I don't really want to see them, actually. I'd get hurt if there was enough people saying, do you know what, Kev, we don't want those stats anymore.
15 balls remain of this Essex innings then. As James Fuller in, gone for a ramp, and he's got hold of that out towards a square. It's not where he intended. And the fielder, Joe Weatherly, at deep square, can pick it up quickly. I wonder how his hand is, Kev, playing with a broken hand. What a trooper. Played pretty well as well so far this competition.
I agree with you. I mean, when we first learned that he'd had a fractured hand, he'd got two half centuries in this competition, playing with virtually one hand.
Fuller from the hotel end again. Bowles, Yorker left delivery played back to him. A crowd like that. This hum of the crowd. As I said, everyone's so enthralled into the cricket. You've got bouncy castles going on in the distance, the pick and mix stand, and fish and chip double decker bus, and no one's there.
The cricket.
The cricket is the entertainment. And it's certainly been that this so far this first innings. It's Fuller. Again, tall action, bowls Yorker length, and that's played out into the onside. Joe Weatherly comes round. They're going to come back for two. Good running from Sam and Dass. And that's the end of the over. 18 overs gone then, so 12 balls remain. Essex are on 188 for 7. That seems like a lot, but Hampshire will be very happy with that when you've got an opening stand of 127 runs. This back end, Hampshire have been very impressive.
Now, the cut-off time is now, so I wonder if the umpires might give them one over leeway, but I'm afraid they'll start the last over. They will get penalised.
If it's time within this over, they have to pull it up from whatever ball it is. So say there was 11 balls left, the fielder has to come up at that time. So
Not
even wait until the end of the
right.
over.
Oh, that's interesting. So well, let's have a look at the field now then. I think they may just give them something. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4. Now we've got 5 fielders inside the circle here. So I'm wondering if they've been penalised already. I think you're right. Yeah, it's 2019 and 2018 is the cut-off time. It's going to be Chris Wood then to Sams, who's on 20 off 12. And Wood comes in. Sams hits that up in the air. Hasn't really timed it. The ball just bounces on the 30-yard circle at mid-wicket. And they will take a single. Sams moves on to 21. 189 for 7, and that run rate has just dipped a fraction under 10.5. So again, the Essex innings has not accelerated at all, but then again, might have been difficult to accelerate it even more the way they started.
Yeah, and I think for me, I keep talking about it, it's the wickets that Hampshire have picked up regularly. As soon as you do that, the run rate float tends to slow. It's hard to get going straight away.
Wood into Das. Das drives up to mid-off. They'll take a single. Dawson thinks about throwing, but decides against it. 190 for seven. Das onto four. So we've got five fielders inside the 30-yard circle, which suggests that they have been penalised here. Still 10 balls to go.
Yeah, this happened for Hampshire at Surrey as well. But they had a lot of thinking to do in that early stage.
Wood comes in again. Wrapped on the pad. That's pitched outside leg stump, I think. Wood was appealing, and as he was appealing, they've come through for a single. Leg by signalled. Wood was convinced.
That's well, out.
You think that's out, Emily?
He moved across. He moved across onto the off stump. I don't think that pitched outside a leg. I'd have given that out.
That's why you're up here and not umpiring.
I feel like I'd give everything out that had mine, but unless it was my own, of course. It's never out then.
Yeah, I mean, if you're watching the live picture feed, I guess you've already made your mind up. Swing and a miss outside the off stump. Slightly slower ball there from Chris Wood. Das flailing at that one, missing it by quite a bit.
Yeah, and that run rate climbing down again was literally that ball before was at 10.3 and it's now at 10.2. It was up way over 12 earlier on this inning, so Hampshire are doing really, really well at the death here.
191 for seven. Two balls left of the 19th as Wood comes in, swings it in the air. It's gone over third. It's got a leading edge, and that ball is going to go over the rope. A little bit lucky there from Das. Try to smack that away on the leg side. It's one of those that just goes off the outside edge and just gathers pace as it pitches.
Do you know these strike rate stats that you give us?
Yeah.
Obviously, strike rate's dramatically improved. Can you tell me the area of the ground that they strike the most at Steady. Next time?
How much prep do you want me to do?
It's not like you've got granddad duties or anything, is it?
Not every day, fortunately. That's a wide outside the off stump. Wood's gone for the wide outside off stump delivery, and he's gone a little too much with that one. Still one ball left of the 19th, and it's 196 for seven.
It's only taken me 19 overs to get Grandad Kevin.
I'm surprised it's taken you that long.
1 month old now.
Yeah.
1 month into being a granddad.
Yeah. It's lovely, but it's weird. Oh, that's again wide. Chris Wood again has overdone it. So they're definitely going to get penalised here. Even more in this last over. You said it's per ball. They've got five fielders, but it might be six the next over, wouldn't it?
Is that a rule?
Well, no, isn't it?
I don't feel like you bring another one in.
Oh, is it just the one?
I think it's just the one for however many balls you're over the cut-off point, unless you're into the last over.
Oh,
okay. But I could be wrong.
No, 197%, we'll find out a bit more later anyway, is the last over. That swung away in the air, but it's going to fall short of deep mid-on. It may look for two. Sands is going to run. Ooh, didn't think it was close to being a run out of the bowler's end, but good running anyway, and that is the 19th over completed, and Essex going into over number 20 are 199 for 7, so they will reach the 200 mark. There was 11 off that in the end, which I suppose with a couple of wides actually could have been worse.
Yeah, and Nathan Ellis to bowl the last. Every time I see that man come to bowl, I just think of that final over he bowled at Edgbaston. See Hampshire home. That final ball we had to bowl twice as well. Tell you what an atmosphere, what a vibe here at the Ageas Bowl. Lots of yellow shirts in the crowd, the yellow bucket hats as well, the new addition that are reversible, Kev. You can have yellow or blue. That is unbelievable. That's one for your wardrobe.
Wow.
And there's plenty of them out here tonight. And there's plenty of them in the shop as well. Nathan Ellis bowls, and that's a Yorker length and heaved into the onside by Sams. They're going to run two. Ross Whiteley at deep mid wicket comes round and fires it in. 200 up then for Essex in this final over.
Have you got a bucket hat?
I haven't, but I need to get one now.
Are they all the rage?
The bucket hats are the fashion kit. I reckon you'd look really good in a Hampshire bucket hat, and I feel like this is the content the listeners want to see.
What, online?
Ellis in bowls, and that's full delivery. Is that out? They're appealing for caught behind. Ellis is on one knee. James Vince's arms are like he's signalling a wide. but the umpire just stands there unmoved. Nathan Ellis having a word with the batter, asking if he's hit that. It's a dot ball.
That's quite... Oh, what cam have we got on at the moment? Dance cam on the screen. Oh, it's a couple of, there's a couple of good movers there. A couple of not so good.
It's poor people. Couple what would be top. Your dog? What would be your dog's move, Kev? You're on that screen. What would you do? I feel like you'd panic. Go a bit red. 72 on his back in bowls, and that's a slower delivery out to backward point. Didn't carry. One bounce, good stop in the end from Toby Albert with his new shoes. They're all navy blue to match the kit.
It's interesting, actually. Sams and Ellis are having a bit of a joke there, and they did with that appeal for the court behind, because they have played international T20s together.
Two Australians.
The last time would have been against England, early part of the winter, in the same Australian side.
202 for seven then. All the fielders having them fine leg out on the onside, and the deep cover is Ellis in bowls, and that's a fantastic slower ball again. And Das misses. Has to be one of the best in the game at the moment, this Nathan Ellis. He's got to be playing for Australia in the white ball suit.
It's ridiculous. I mean, Robin Das, I mean, he doesn't need to feel too bad about that, because how many batters have we seen that actually get completely done by that slower ball? I mean, it's great to watch, isn't it? Where they've just absolutely thrown the bat at it and the ball's nowhere near them. It hasn't even arrived yet.
They're going to put their back out. Just three runs so far off this final over. Two balls remain as Ellis in bowls, and that's a quicker delivery. Finds Liam Dawson at extra cover, who again watches it bounce and is on his knees to say, I just can't read it today. 203 for seven then, final ball. As a plane takes off in the sky to our right.
Nice sight, isn't it?
Ben McDermott with his red gloves, ready to take the final delivery before he looks forward to getting out there with a bat with the Hampshire skipper, James Vince, as Nathan Ellis skips, charges in past the umpire, bowls, that's hit hard down the ground, and that's six runs. That's a good finish, that, for Essex. But after Hampshire's start, I'm pretty sure they'll be happy with 209 for seven. Das finishes on 11 off 9. Sam's on 30 off 18. But this is going to be one hell of a chase for Hampshire. But what a pitch it looks to bat on.
Well, it is a very good one. I think the best pitch we've seen here this season. It's not the hybrids, which are just to the right. This is just to the left of centre. And it looks a very, very good pitch indeed. But, you know, because Ellis and Sams know each other, I'm just wondering if Ellis has bowled a quicker ball there because he thinks that Sams is expecting the slower ball, and he's actually in the end. You know, it's in the slot almost, isn't it? Sams has absolutely mullered that over mid-off. But, you know, even so, you know, it's a big total. There's no doubt about that. But it could have been an awful lot more. And, you know, I think Hampshire, they might not be pleased that they've gone for that many. But actually, 209 for seven, it is a good score. Of course it's a good score, and Hampshire are going to have to play brilliantly well. But it's gettable.
Yeah, definitely. As I said, if you're a batter, you'll want your pads on out there. But all I'm going to say to finish on this innings, what a credit to John Turner. Four overs for 19, three wickets. Absolutely unbelievable from the young seamer. And we're going to be on for a thriller of a chase here. Hampshire need 210 to win.
Except myself and Emily, we'll be back with you shortly. that I mentioned before the start of this game, that on five of the six occasions that James Vince has scored 50 plus runs, Hampshire have won, and on four of the five occasions that Vince has got less than 50, Hampshire have lost. That would suggest, Emily Windsor, that James Vince is going to play a crucial part in this one, Chase.
Yep, I agree, and it's what the Hampshire fans want to see as well, that's for sure. I think James Vince knows how to play here on this ground. But also, for me, Ben McDermott could do some damage here. I feel like this is a type of pitch where the ball's coming on, probably more similar to Australia. He could play a good knock as well. He's been in pretty good touch this tournament so far. All blue of Essex out in the middle.
Now we've got the first ball being bowled by Sams, and that's edged. It's gone down to short third by McDermott. And the first ball is a dot ball. We didn't see too many dot balls in the first 10 overs or so of the Essex innings, but the first ball that Hampshire have faced is one. Well, McDermott has scored just over 300 runs in this year's tournament, striking at 138, and that's around about where he strikes career-wise. He's just under that, just a fraction, so that's pretty decent. James Vince is striking at 160 this year, as opposed to 135 for him. Sam's left arm over, McDermott comes down the wicket, works it on the leg side. I mean, they really have got to go from it from the word go, aren't you? Which is, as you, I think you were saying earlier, that it's all right, but it could actually result in Hampshire being all out pretty quickly, or actually, again, getting away to a fast start, which they really need.
Yeah, but you say that, Kev. I think this is a team that we don't tend to see lightning starts. They tend to build a bit in their innings and potentially maybe a bit more structured through that middle, especially on a ground that they know, their home ground. I think the most important thing for me is that they have wickets in hand at the death, and I think this is a type of pitch, if you do, it's going to be hard to defend.
James Vince faces his first delivery. It's a good one. He just works it out on the onside. Throw comes into Vince's end, it hits the stumps, and they're going to be ricochet runs as Harmer runs after it towards the extra cover boundary, and they actually get three, whereas it might have only been one. Well, it was a good throw. I think it was Froze Kushi that threw the stumps down at the bowler's end, but it's one of those where you get penalised for hitting the stumps.
Yeah, and that means Hampshire now off to a good start. Four off three deliveries, but effortless, risk-free at the moment. And as I said, wickets in hand for me is the most crucial thing, and at Essex, if they get early wickets, they're going to be on top.
McDermott to face Sams, left arm over. McDermott gets a length ball, just plays it back to the bowler. Nice arrow straight delivery there from the Australian to the Australian.
But looking at this Hampshire batting lineup as well, they've got firepower in that lower middle order. James Fuller and Benny Howe are probably the two crucial players in that. We saw Benny Howe play a fantastic knock down at Sussex and out to that ridiculous catch. It's Brad Curry, Scott Curry's brother. That went viral, that did, but they do have the depth towards the lower end, but the top order need to do the majority of the work.
Here's Samson, the pavilion end. McDermott drives on the up through extra cover. There's the first boundary of the Hampshire reply. Well received by this very good crowd here at the Ageas Bowl. And Hampshire move on to eight without loss, needing just another 202 to win the game. A mere 202.
Proper shot though, that from Ben McDermott. Just use the pace, hit through the ball. It's that type of pitch. Low risk, all into the ground. Four runs.
Sams with his last ball of this first over. Kushi will throw at the bowler's end. This time it misses. Harmer's backing up. Doesn't look as though he's going to be shy at having a dart there for Ozkushi when it goes out towards him at mid-wicket. One over gone. Hampshire are nine without loss, chasing 210 for victory.
Yeah, that cue for the bouncy castle on the hill behind the pavilion. A little longer now, Kev. It's one where you've got to stand and you've got to take a diving catch left or right. But it's a real spectacular evening, isn't it, I think. The sun's still setting in the distance. To our right, we're going to be in for a beautiful sunset, that's for sure. Those braving the sun in their eyes. To the left of the ground as we look, still just about in the sun.
Still nice and warm, isn't it?
Certainly is. We're still in shorts and t-shirt. Well, I am.
You are. Yeah, you're very summery today.
It's a warm one. Aaron Beard then, who's come into the side today. Right arm seamer. Be bowling from the hotel end with the new ball into McDermott, who goes hard and it'll be signalled a wide. He advanced, but in the end sort of pulled out the shot.
Bit of movement there actually, away from the batter as well. He's quite a skiddy bowler, Aaron Beard. One of the two changes in the Essex side from the side that lost to Kent last night on their home ground. Ben Allison will be the other one we'll see, the other bowler shortly.
From Ben McDermott, that was going the distance. It'll just be a single out to deep square leg and get hold of that, but he moves to 7, 11 without loss, Hampshire Hawks. Seagulls again in the distance, swooping in and play.
It's weird, isn't it, because at the level we're on, they fly that level, so it's a bit weird seeing them at their normal sort of hovering height. As they say.
Beard in, bowls, and in defence, the captain, James Vince.
As the people that follow birds say. Chris Packham and co.
That's so
he often uses that terminology, Chris Packham.
You sound like a bird watcher.
I'm not.
Is that your new hobby as a granddad?
Is that what granddads do? Suddenly, as you can become a granddad, you suddenly become a bird watcher and things like that.
He's got blue soled boots then, Beard bowls, advances again. This time not signalled a wide by the umpire. And for me, that one looked wider.
Certainly looked debatable because James Vince is still looking, saying, well, why is that not called a wide? It's definitely shaping away as well, isn't it, really? Which is, I guess, giving the umpire a bit to think about, but decided that it's okay.
Beard then back to top of his mark, turns and scurries in to Vince, and that's hit high down the ground. Lovely shot by James Vince, that's straight into the hover cover. Hit sweet as you like. First 6 of this Hampshire innings goes to the captain, James Vince. He moves to 9 off 4 deliveries, scores 17 without loss.
That's a clean hit, isn't it? Elbow, high elbow through the shot as well. You could tell Vince loved that.
Didn't move, did he?
He did enjoy that shot, you could tell. I was just about to say, Aaron Baird is probably the only bowler we've seen, seam bowler, to get it off the straight. I mean, quite, but that actually has just gone straight up and down, hasn't it?
He's allowed to swing it for 3 balls. Well, 2 balls for that matter. As he's in then, mid-off, mid-on, inside the circle. Bowls, length, delivery, cut through! A very packed cover field. And that's 4 more runs to James Vince. Again, hit the middle of that bat. He moves to 13, 21 without loss, Hampshire.
Well, James Vince has already passed 500 runs in this year's competition. Last year he was Hampshire's top run scorer with 678, but of course there's a quarter-final, semi-final and final included in that.
Clubs in the distance, little children standing on their feet, waving those 4s and 6 signs to the beat of this music. DJ has a lot on his shoulders tonight with his big crowd.
Can't please everybody with the tunes.
It's pleasing me so far. It's Bird. In again to Vince, bowls, and that's worked to mid-wicket misfield. Through his legs at mid-wicket. They're going to come back for a couple. Paul Water does the tidying up. But valuable runs for Hampshire. Good over that. 14 runs from it. 23 without loss, Hampshire, after 2 overs.
That was Ben Allison there. Now, I thought that 6 off the last ball, you think, when there's a 6 off the last ball, you think, if it's a tight game, you'll look back on that. I mean, he's just given Hampshire 2 runs back at that 6.
And Hampshire in the lead. Essex at the same point with 22 without loss.
That was after that over that went for 1 at John Turner. Well, Hampshire can do no more. If we keep saying that after every couple of overs, especially the first 10, they'll have done remarkably well. Emily's catch is still on the big screen there. Certain wine sponsor, which she did with the Vipers, what, 2 years ago?
Yeah, I look remarkably younger.
I'm
going to take that to offence, actually. Yeah. I look like a grandma now.
This is Alison, and that's hoiked away on the leg side by Ben McDermott. greeting Ben Allison, and that is four runs down to fine leg. I mean, listen, you're still young now, of course you are, but you look amazingly young in that advert 2 years ago. You look like a little baby in that.
I was 2 years younger. I'm going to give Ben a little bit more credit. That was a fantastic ramp shot, and he's played that so well this year. That Surrey, I remember watching on the live stream, he played a couple when they're bowling length. It's a low-risk shot, and now they've put a fielder out there because of it.
Right, I'm over. Allison is trying to swing that away on the leg side, misses. If he connected with that, we'd be looking for the ball for a while. He's on 11 off 7 deliveries, 8 deliveries, Ben McDermott. Thinks he's 15 off 6. Just another 183 needed. The Souvaki stall, the Greek Souvaki stall, the way to our left, still has a few people queuing up. They must have sold a bit of that tonight.
Which George Adams is treating us to, Kev.
Yeah, looking forward to that. I saw a picture of that earlier on the internet. It looks a lovely dish. No wonder it's had good queues. Allison bowls again, swings, misses. It's gone a bit more over the top of the stumps this time. He's trying to aim for sort of mid-wicket, mid-on here. There is a fielder out at deep back on square leg, but the fielders at mid-wicket and mid-on are inside the 30-yard circle. McDermott just needs to connect with one of those. Bowls quite in, doesn't he, Allison? He's got an action which sort of leans quite a bit, doesn't he, to the left as he bowls, angling it in to the right-hander, pushing it in. Yeah, that helps him push it in anyway. Comes in again and bowls on the line of leg stump. That's worked away by McDermott, and that is split the field, four runs. Nicely timed.
That's better for me from Ben McDermott. The two balls before, he's tried to muller all the way to Portsmouth. This is a classy cricket shot, and you get the reward when the outfield's this quick and on this type of pitch.
Using the angle as well, wasn't it, coming into him. Two boundaries off this over. Takes the Hawks onto 31 without loss. McDermott onto 15. That's the same score as Vince. Remember, Essex made 209 for 7 off their 20 as Allison comes in again. Again, it's flicked away with a bit more pace this time, but it's straight to the fielder at deep. Single to McDermott, takes him on to 16, 32 without loss. Sun in the west, away to our right. Still shining brightly, but most of the sun disappearing over the playing area. In fact, Vince is in sunshine, but McDermott isn't.
James Vince.
Yeah, it's like a little tunnel.
There's no other players.
Funnel, isn't there?
There's no other players in sunshine.
You're right. The field is either side of Vince or in shadows, but Vince is actually in sunlight. It's like there's a stage light on him as he cuts that away, and no wonder. And I think that's going to be cut off. They think about two, they decide against it. Good throw as well, probably just as well. 33 without loss at the end of three.
I think both teams would be relatively happy with this start. I think these two, if they build a big partnership, a bit like Essex did, it's going to be hard to defend on this pitch. It's a pitch where the margin for error as a bowling unit is so small. Such a good outfield, and I think we're going to see spin for this fourth over in the power play, Simon Harmer.
Interesting move, isn't it? Liam Dawson waited till the end of the power play to bowl his first over. No Mason Crane tonight. Hampshire unchanged for the fourth game running.
Big game this. Let's emphasise that. Essex currently sitting third in the group table. Hampshire fourth. Three games to go. Must win for both of these teams. There's Harmer. The right arm off spinner. Ball's darted into James Vince on his pads. He's turned into the onside. They're going to think about two. Ben McDermott, big shout of no. Great bit of work down there from Aaron Beard. Quick to the ball.
That was good fielding, good throw, wasn't it?
Vince is on 17. A further 176 needed. 16.5 overs. Harmer in, and that's hit high up into the air by Ben McDermott. There is a fielder under it, and he takes the catch. Paul Water there. His long levers, all 6 for 8 of him. Good catch going back over his head, but Ben McDermott has to go for 16 off 12. And that's Hampshire's first wicket lost. Scored 34 for 1.
Well, that's a blow, isn't it, really? I mean, Ben McDermott in full flow, complimenting James Vince. There's always an opening partnership which does damage, and you feel that they kind of needed to tonight. Out of all the onion partnerships that they've done so far this season, you needed a big one from them. An awful lot of work to do. Now, Toby Albert is the new man coming out now. He's still relatively new to this. This is only his 23rd T20 match, but his strike rates are a little down on the others. He's 115 overall, and even this season, he's only striking around 116, so I'm not sure how much we can expect from him here. I think James Vince might have to take a little more charge, especially if Albert bats for a little while here.
Yeah, but I think for Hampshire, the most important thing is James Vince bats for the longest period as possible, so Albert can't make it too hard. As Harmer's then in on his pads, that's worked to a gap at square leg. They're going to run the first one hard. They come back for two. He's going to have to hurry. Great bit of running from Toby Albert. That's a good way to get off the mark. Just manipulating the field. He's on two then. The score 36 for one. Hampshire, 174 required to win.
Well, it may just be the making of Toby Albert tonight, because he really has got to get a move on. Can't be hanging around tonight.
He's a clever cricketer, isn't he, Toby Albert? You see a lot of ramps and paddles, yeah, especially to the seamers, as Harmer in, quicker, and that's worked to that fielder that's at square leg inside the circle, will be a dot ball.
So some good overs, good innings in the 50-over game, which is coming up in August.
He's got his navy blue boots on and his yellow pads. It's Harmer in, bowls, that's swept, and again finds that fielder at square leg, but they come through for a single. Good option from Albert. It is his boundary option with square leg inside the circle. He's on three then, 37 for one.
That's the danger though with Simon Harmer, is that that's slightly quicker in the arm ball as well, and he gets so many wickets in red ball cricket with balls like that.
It's a clever off spinner. Once he's in, that's worked into the onside by Vince. That's the final ball of the over. So Vince will take the strike then. He moves to 18 off 9. 38 for 1 off 4 overs.
That's a good over, wasn't it? 5 runs off it. Spinner bowling in the power play. That's what Simon Harmer's all about, isn't he, really? I think it wasn't that long ago, actually, that Essex didn't play him in T20. So I think it's only in the last 2 or 3 seasons where he's sort of come back in and playing major parts. But we all know him, of course, as a red ball spinner. But he's still clever. Changes of pace.
Now the captain.
And captain as well. Paul Walter on with his left arm seamers. What was he, 6 foot?
8.
8. Ooh. He's playing his 97th match tonight, and he's looking for his 50th wicket. He's on 49 currently. And he's going to be bowling to James Vince. Let's hope that 50th wicket doesn't come right now, from a Hampshire point of view. He's from the pavilion end then, comes in and bowls, and Vince hammers that away on the leg side. Looks like a slow ball bouncer, that one. Vince was just waiting for that a fraction, which is why he sort of slightly mishit that. Moves on to 19, 39 for one. The Hawks, 171 needed, and we are at the start of the fifth. Terrific, terrific crowd tonight. The biggest crowd, I think, of the T20 season so far. Still another one to come next Friday. That's against Glamorgan. As Albert goes in the air. Now this could be caught at backward fine leg. No, it just outstretched. Past the outstretched hand of the fielder, and the ball just bounces. The fielder stumbles and it hits the road. That was a funny bit of fielding. Or not.
Well, that's a bit of luck, isn't it, that Hampshire need when you're chasing these big totals. You need those small things to go your way. This will be a test for Toby Albert though. Sometimes, you know what, these big chases as a batter, when you just have to play with that intent, it can help you.
True. 43 for one. Rabin Das was the man there. That's a lovely cut away by Albert, but actually straight to the man at deep point. That was a lovely piece of timing, but unfortunately the placement meant it went straight out to the only man in the deep.
And Toby Albert only batting at 3 because of that injury to Tom Prestu, who we haven't seen for the majority of this competition. He fractured his ankle, I think it was. So he's been a miss to the
He's
Hampshire
been a big miss.
Order.
I'm told he might be available for the last two group games. That's hammered away by Vince, although not quite time, but they will get 2 turns. He'll have to hurry, but he'll be home. Yeah, I was told a little while ago that Prest is looking to be back for the final two home games, and I think available and hope that he gets in, I would think he'll be straight back in. He was quite a big player, wasn't he, at number three? I know Toby Albert's done a pretty good, decent job, to be fair to him. But I think Prest had that position his, didn't he? It was his position to lose.
Yeah, very much so. He's a very talented young cricketer, and there's elements of him when I see him bat that remind me of James Vince, the way he plays. So a big miss to this Hampshire batting lineup.
Walter bowls to Vince, gets wrapped on the pad. Oh, Albert comes down, but he'll be all right because the keeper has a bit to do. Will Buttleman to run up to the stumps and pick it up. Maybe could have been a single there, but I think Vince thinks that even though he missed out that ball, he might not necessarily miss out the next one. 46 for one.
Fielders are set out there, Kev,
they are, aren't they?
On that deep square mid-wicket boundary. Shut off that offside for James Vince.
Vince was looking over on that leg side as well. Here comes Walter, bowl slightly slower ball. Vince gives himself some room, goes up to mid-off. They'll pick up a single. That'll end Walter's first over. And the Hawks are 47 for one. Five gone. 15 to go. The run rate currently is just over 9.5, and they require just over 10.5. So no panic stations yet.
Yeah, for me, you look at where Essex were at that same point. They were to catch up at the back end because Essex had such a slow sort of late to middle overs where they didn't go for many. So if Hampshire can navigate this, probably not losing another wicket. They know this playing surface better than anyone else, and hopefully they can manipulate that field better. So very much in the game. 210 the target. Fantastic opening partnership between Dan Lawrence and Kushi. There's Daniel Sams in from the hotel in bowls, and that's worked nicely by James Vince. That'll be four. Behind, backward a point, backward a square, and Vince moves to 26 or 40. That's 50 up for Hampshire, 51 for one.
You know, I was listening to the interview that Daniel Sams gave BBC Essex and the club, I think, after the game, which Hampshire won quite convincingly up at Chelmsford earlier on in this competition. Vince got 103 on that day, and he was asked about Vince, and he said, you know, he's one of the most difficult players to bowl at because he's very clever the way he plays. Doesn't just try and blast everything.
Sam's in, and that's hit down the ground. That's a huge shot as well. That's six runs. Length delivery, hit on the up over and mid on inside the circle. And that's what the Hampshire fans would like to see more of this evening. He's on 32, 57 for one.
Well, I'll just go back to my comment where he said he doesn't blast everything. Well, he did that one, but he says he's very difficult because a lot of players, when you bowl to them in T20, they're looking to blast. So he says, you know, you can sort of try and sort of work them out. But he says with Vince, he won't blast you every ball. He works you around.
He's in again. That's pulled away this time. Wow. That's flew off his bat. Backward a square. That's times better than any shot we've seen this evening. All along the floor. He moves to 36, 61 for one.
You know, that's really clever batting as well, because Sams had just pitched the ball up previously, goes over his head for six. So Vince knows he's going to pull the length back a little bit. So he's already waiting for that. It wasn't that short, but he's just helped that away on the leg side. Terrific stuff.
Sams there almost laughing as he walks back to his mark, probably thinking, where do I bowl here?
Exactly right. He's reinforced that leg side field, though.
Two fielders are out there waiting. Offside up now. Sam's in again, four, and that's driven. Mid off does well, dive into his left. They come through for a quick single. He has to hurry. They're thinking of two. He's slid. He's on the deck. And he's practicing a cover drive. We know he's alright if he's up playing the cover drive, those Hampshire fans, but a chaotic single, 62 for one.
Big over already, 15 off it. But that was unlucky. That could have quite easily gone for four. Probably another 6 inches away from Simon Harmer. It was hit with enough venom. It probably would have done as well. And then Sam would have been under massive pressure in this over. He's still. But he probably feels now bowling at Toby Albert, he might just be let off a little bit towards the end. Unless Albert can find a big shot.
Good over so far for Hampshire. Sam's then the Australian. Left arm over the wicket. He's gone for a ramp. And that's high up in the air. That's going to fly down. And that's going to be signalled 6 runs to Toby Albert. He plays that shot so well to the seamers. Low risk cricket shot for him. He moves to 14, 68 for 1 Hampshire. Big over this.
Well, you're right. 36 off 33 in the last game against Gloucestershire on Tuesday night, and he did at least one of those down in Bristol. You're right, and it's one of his shots. And this is becoming a massive over.
21 from it so far. One ball remains. Sam's in short, and that's hit up in the air, and that's been given out, caught behind. Sam's enjoyed that one. Bumper. Albert's gone after it. Taken very well by Buttleman, the keeper. Big wicket that for Essex. Toby Albert's gone for 14 off 7, 68 for 2.
Well, that's a good comeback, isn't it, really? Sam's. It was a big over here, and to finish it off with a wicket. That's a quick ball, wasn't it? Pace. It was short, but it was with pace. And Albert, with a bit of bounce, just got a little bit too much underneath it. And a good catch from Will Buttleman as well. Good comeback from the Essex player, but I'm not sure Hampshire would take a big over with a wicket in it, but it was a big over nonetheless.
Yeah, absolutely. Joe Weatherly comes to the crease for Hampshire. Big applause from the crowd. Favourite here, that's for sure. His broken hand, he's out there in the middle. Good competition so far, Joe Weatherly. Sure, Kev will tell us the strike rate, so I won't want to take his thunder on that.
No, be my guest.
He's scored 251 runs so far, averaging 35, strike rate of 124. More steady in that middle order. But if he can bat alongside James Vince, it will be exactly what Hampshire need at this point. 142 required to win then, on 14 overs. 68 for 2. The sun, Kev, is setting beautifully to our right.
So is his nap. Here's Sir Aaron Baird with his skiddy seamers, and that's cut away by James Vince through extra cover. Good piece of fielding on the boundary. Is his feet over the rope as he's pulled that ball back? Umpire, have a look.
Kev, if that's not given four.
The crowd don't like it, to the right.
If that's not given four.
Well, the umpires don't seem too bothered. That needs a second look. It needs a slow-mo on that. Crowd on that right-hand side. I suppose they would do, but it definitely needs a second look, but it won't get one. 70 for 2. Vince is on 39 as Baird from the pavilion end comes in again. It's full. It's worked on the onside. There'll only be a single. Vince moves on to 40, and that's off just 19 deliveries. I won't keep mentioning that stat that I mentioned earlier, but it seems very relevant here as Hampshire have already lost 2 wickets. McDermott for 16, Albert for 14.
That was that?
Eh?
The James Vince that?
Yes. Did you like that one?
I did.
I will repeat it shortly for people that have just joined us. I won't mention it again because I've already mentioned it a couple of times.
That's your big money stat, that.
I'm putting everything on that. Here's Baird, bowls to Weatherly, who's off the mark, turning that away on the leg side. And Hampshire move on to 72 for 2, and we are in the 7th over. They're on track at the moment, Hampshire. They need another 138. That's still a long way, but they've made a decent start.
Yeah, this making use of this pitch. Still think, for me, James Vince is key. If he goes on and scores big, Hampshire are going to be in a very good position.
Pulls that away, James Vince, and he spears the field. That's running down the tunnel. That might just end up in the nursery ground, away to our left. It's completely gone down the middle of the tunnel, unless there's some machinery there that'll run out the gate at the other end.
God, it's come back quickly.
Oh, it's come back now. It's hit something. There's obviously a bit of machinery in the way. There's quite a lot of machinery under there. There's an awful lot.
And do you know what? For the Arctic Monkeys that was on there last week, completely emptied because they had to get all the stage through that tunnel.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow.
So they've only just filled it back up, and to be honest, looking from here, it doesn't look fully full at the moment.
It doesn't, does it? 72 for 2. Here's Baird to Vince. Vince guides that towards back quarter point. I think that's Robin Das there. level in the fielding. So Vince has 40 or 20, striking at 200. We've seen that a bit tonight, haven't we? Dan Lawrence was very much around there, and Feroz Kushi for a while. Been some big striking tonight. 72 for 2 as we come towards the end of the 7th. The run rate for Hampshire, they're just under 11 and they need just under 10.5, so they're going well. Oh, it's a leading edge, but he's got away with it, Vince. Get down, says Emily Windsor. And it bounces between the fielders on the 30-yard circle and the fielder coming in from the rope. A little bit of luck there for James Vince.
Yeah, he's just trying to help that on the onside into that gap. He's going so hard at it, it's almost hit the middle of his edge to fly over the inner ring. James Vince, a good touch at the moment. 45 off 22. Such an impressive competition so far. When do you think that James Vince is not currently in England's T20 white ball squad? It shows you the skill, the talent that there is in the country at the moment. It's scary.
It is, isn't it, really? And he's not, I presume he might be talked about, but it doesn't feel like he is, doesn't it?
Could you imagine James Vince in baseball and the test?
You think he's right up there with what they want, isn't he? But they'll pick some other guy who's a little younger, and, which is fair enough. I mean, he's only got, mind you, it wasn't that long ago he was playing T20 cricket for England.
Matt Critchley into the attack then. It's leg spin, bowls, and that's hit hard by James Vince. There is a fielder out with deep cover, but you're not stopping that. He moves the 49 off 23, 81 for 2.
Terrific stuff.
And that's exactly what you were saying earlier about how Daniel Sam said, how do you bowl to James Vince, because he plays those shots. That's textbook cover drive that he'll try to overhit it, but his timing, and he's definitely one of the best timers of the ball in this country. Welcome to the game, the leg spinner, as he's in this time hard along the floor on the leg side. There's three fielders out. James Vince, 53 of 24 balls, raises his bat very quickly and his head's down, ready on this game. But the crowd absolutely love that, and these are two fabulous shots, Kev. I'm in awe.
Sixth time he's passed 50 this season in this competition.
Critchley again bowls, and that's pushed into the offside, up to mid-off. Paul Walters coming in. They think about two. The answer's no from Joe Weatherly, and I think that was a sensible call in the end. 86 for 2 then. 124 needed off 12 overs.
And the run rate required from here on in has just dropped below 10.
Suspense is building. Crowd. Critchley into Weatherly, and that's off the back foot. Appeal for caught behind. The keeper throws it in the air. And the umpire's not moved. Joe Weatherly just stands there. Play a miss. Wide angle. Again, gone to a sweep shot, hit him on the pad. Appeal for RBW given. Joe Weatherly's gone, attempting to sweep for one. And that's Hampshire's third wicket gone, 86 for 3.
Well, it looked pretty close, didn't it, really, when you watch it on the replay, if you're watching the live picture feed. And it is his shot, Joe Weatherly. It just looked as though it was a fraction too full. It was certainly too straight. And of course, when the ball's as straight as that to a spinner, you really are struggling if you haven't got some sort of bat on that. So Hampshire have lost their third wicket now on 86. And just with every wicket that falls, you just feel that James Vince's innings becomes even more important. Now, Ross Whiteley, ordinarily in this year's competition, I'd have been a little worried about him walking to the crease, because he has struggled a bit. There's been absolutely no doubt about that, and I think we can all agree on that. But actually, there were signs in the game against Gloucestershire on Tuesday night that his touch was returning. 41 not out of just 25 balls. That was more the sort of Ross Whiteley that we know. His strike rates and his runs have been well down this year. He's just not really been able to connect with anything. But on Tuesday night, he just looked a bit more like his old self.
left-handed then. Two fielders out on the leg side as he's in and bowls, and that's cut to a short extra cover and fired back to him. Will be a dot ball to start. That's eight overs gone then. 12 overs remain and the score 86 for three. I feel this partnership for Hampshire is going to be let's build a partnership. If these two take close, then it could be Hampshire's game, but with every wicket that falls, the weight gets heavier on James Vince's shoulders. 86 for three. Beautiful orange sunset into our right. The bouncy castle's deflated because all eyes are now on the cricket.
How can that go down already? Here's Simon Harmer, switched ends with his off spin down the leg side. That's a wide. Well taken by the keeper, Butterman, though. Emily Windsor's just going to get a fleece on because all of a sudden the temperature has dropped. Not by much, but obviously enough for Emily to go and get a top. And that's worked away on the onside by Vince. And he moves on to 55. Didn't waste much time there with the sun disappearing. Right.
Slightly warmer now.
It is noticeable, actually. It's dropped 3 or 4 degrees, hasn't it, very quickly. With the sun. Although it's still there on the horizon, way to our right. Very red. It's lovely here when that happens. Whiteley's trying to find an angle on the leg side. Doesn't find it. It's around now, isn't it, where that red sun sort of just shines and hovers over the horizon away to our right. It's a beautiful setting. There's Whiteley. Plays and misses. And he's got caught behind. And I don't think he quite believes that he's out. Vince looks at the umpire as well at the non-striker's end, and the umpire's given Whiteley out. Well, I think even from here, I'm not 100% sure that either batter thinks that Whiteley was out, but Essex certainly did. And Whiteley has to go. And that is a big blow. Whiteley goes for no score. And Hampshire, after a decent start, just being pegged back here as well. 88 for 4, and they've lost. Well, they've lost 3 wickets for 20, but 2 for 2.
Yeah, I feel like Ross Whiteley's disappointed with that decision. But again, James Vince is so crucial here, but Hampshire just needs someone to stick around with him, I think. The run rate now is over 10s again, but build a partnership at this stage. Get James Vince back on strike because he's finding the boundaries easily. So just manipulate that field, get up the other end, let James Vince do the damage that he's doing so effortlessly at the moment.
Well, we know Fuller is a big striker of the ball. Cameo half century for him would be absolutely what's called for here. Simon Harmer's done it again, picked up McDermott early on, now he's picked up Ross Whiteley. Just has that habit, Simon Harmer.
James Fuller not had a good competition so far with the bat, just 21 runs, averaging 5, so that's not the James Fuller we're used to.
It's not. Quicker ball there, and he's wrapped on the pad. My word, that was a much quicker ball there from Harmer. I've seen him bowl some quicker balls, and that was about as quick as I've seen him bowl one. I don't know if he thought Fuller was going to try and sweep him there. Comes in again and bowls. It's fired in a little bit, but it's played back to the bowler. And I just feel that Essex are just getting on top here. 122 Hampshire still need, coming towards the end of the ninth. And James Vince, once more, is the key for Hampshire. Fuller goes big, 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 big over mid-on. Well, we've seen two or three up that way, and I think that's the biggest of the several that we've seen. Flat bat, and that's gone about 10 rows back into the Colin Ingleby McKenzie.
Yeah, that will do for Hampshire. That's how James Fuller plays. He goes hard at the ball. Here, no, he's not had the competition he'd liked so far with the bat, but those people that have followed Hampshire would have known the damage he'd done last year with both the bat and the ball. Hampshire management backing him to do that tonight, sending him in at number 6. Potentially you could have sent in Liam Dawson, who would have been a bit more of a steadier option to bat alongside James Vince. We're obviously holding him back.
Yeah, you don't want to put too much pressure on Vince here, do you, really? You want somebody else that's, in a way, outscores him. Which allows Vince to play the way he wants to play.
Beard into his attack. into the attack for his third over. He's gone for 23 off his two so far. As he's into Vince Bowles, that's hit to extra cover, call of no, James Fuller was running at him. James Vince doesn't want to risk a run out. 94 for four. Hampshire Hawks require another 116 to win. 10.5 overs, so 65 balls, 116 required. And a belting pitch. His beard in, Vince gives him room, hits that hard down the ground. There is a fielder at long on who does a fantastic diving effort, but he's pushed it along the boundary rope for four. And this is what I mean, when James Vince is hitting it this well, get him on strike. He's on 59 off 28. Score 98 for four.
Paul Walter, that is, just below us. Well, he's not just below us, he's a long way below us actually, because we're so high up.
Beard then, what will his response be? Into Vince, gives himself room, pulled into the onside. There's a fielder at deep mid-wicket. And he sticked for a single. The left-handed Daniel Sams, it is out there. Vince moves to 60, 99 for four.
Well, I will repeat the stat just for a minute. Five of the six occasions where Vince has got 50 runs plus, Hampshire have won those matches. That's this year's competition.
Beard into Fuller. That's a short ball, and that's nice. An over. Ed High at head height will be one for the over, but not called a wide. Good carry.
Was, wasn't it? Pace in that one.
Interesting field placement. A really, really fine third man outside the circle.
It is, isn't it?
A deep cover, a long on, a mid wicket. And a square leg, all on the boundary. As Beard into Fuller, he's worked that nicely past a fine leg. He's just come up. There'll definitely be two. Fuller moves to eight. 101 for four then. Hampshire Hawks 100 up.
Sounds like a darts match. Like Ali Pally. 100.
Listen to that crowd. It's a busy one tonight. It's Beard into Fuller, who sets himself like he's going to smack it and hits it straight back to the bowler. That's the end of the over then. 10 overs gone, we're halfway. Hampshire 101 for four at the same place. Essex 127 for one.
Behind, but we do know that Essex didn't exactly accelerate, did they? The first 10 overs was the best half of their innings.
And they've got James Vince at the crease.
Yeah, I have James Vince. And maybe... The sun has just about disappeared over the horizon. I can literally see a small fraction of it. In fact, as I speak, the sun has just disappeared over the horizon as Harmer continues from the pavilion end. Bowls to Vince. Vince drives. Good stop by Harmer. Good stop. That was hit very straight and hard. That may just have split the field at the far end. As Harmer quickly back to his mark, comes in again and bowls to Vince. Vince hammers that away on the leg side, but a couple of bounces out to deep mid-wicket. Vince, you can tell it, he gets really disappointed because as he completes a round, he just sort of flicks the bat up in the air and catches it.
When he slightly mistimes one. Still hit a ball harder than I've ever hit one in my life. He's disappointed.
Good strike from him. There is two fielders up there, deep mid on, deep mid off. And the deep mid on really struggled to get anywhere near that one. That's a good shot. 106 for four, the Hawks, as Harmer comes in again and bowls. Fuller works that away. Now this is wider mid on as well, but to his right this time. Good fielding on the boundary. It's just the two. And the Hawks move on to 108 for four. Run rate is around about 11 and over from here on in.
Skillful batting that from James Vince. From James Fuller, sorry. Just hitting that gap, hitting that pocket, running well.
Yes, now the field's changing. Now they've got an extra fielder going up there by the pavilion. Now he's almost behind the bowler's arm. What is going on there? That's
three,
a very unusual field.
There's a wall of fielders.
There is, isn't there? That's a very unusual.
A mid-on and a centre-mid.
For the drives, wide a mid-off. That's the way to answer that field placing. Just step away to leg and hit it a little squarer.
Tell you what, if they want a wall of straight fielders, they need to bring square leg up now and send out deep extra cover.
I mean, it is fairly well blocked off, isn't it, with fielders on the boundary, but of course they've still got their four inside the 30-yard circle. Full of cuts, oh, it's gone to the fielder. That could have quite easily been four more. Fuller is playing just the sort of cameo innings we hoped he would when he walked to the middle. We of course want more from him. It is taking the pressure off James Vince, which again is the right way to play. Vince has 61 off 31. Fuller has 19 off 10. The Hawks are 113 for 4 off 11, and they still need 97 for.
Yeah, if with these two at the crease though, anything can happen. The sun really is setting. The lights you can start to see of all the food outlets. A bit of Mika. This DJ is delivering tonight, Kevin James.
You've enjoyed the music, haven't you?
I've enjoyed it more now Mika's come on.
Is that right? Is he your favourite?
He is my favourite. Well, he's one of my favourites. If you ask the Southern Vipers dressing room. Paul Walter then. 6 for 8, and that's hit over fine leg by James Fuller. Two bounces over the boundary rope, and that'll be 4 runs. He moves to 23, 117 for 4.
Is that what the Vipers listen to in the dressing room?
What I make them listen to.
Oh, you do? Oh, dear.
If there's a karaoke song, mine's Mika.
Well, this is the first time that Fuller's actually gone into double figures in this year's tournament.
And the wall of fielders this time is out all on the leg side. As Walter round the wicket, full and played into the offside. They come through for a quick single. Dug that out well, James Fuller. He moves to 24 off 12, 118 for 4.
Yeah, it's well bowled, wasn't it? Fuller played it well, didn't try and thrash it away, just let the ball come into him, which he did. Still, the Suvaki stall has a few people waiting to be served. A few of the other outlets look as though they've done most of the business, if not all, by now.
Walter creeping to James Vince, who's pulled that out to one of the deep square leg fielders. It'll just be a single. Again, Vince looks up to the sky, livid with himself that he's absolutely timed a ball to deep square leg. He's on 62 then, 119 for 4.
I'm sure he wasn't just checking to see if the sun had really set on the horizon.
If he does that, he'll be looking up at 6 beaming floodlights. As Walter creeps past the umpire, bowls, and that's pulled into the onside, just short of a deep mid-wicket. And Sam's out there. Vince into 62s, Fuller's 25, 120 for 4, 90 required then. 8.2 overs.
Run rate still hovering around 10. It's just over 10 and a half from here on in.
Sam scurrying in behind the umpire, jumps out to Vince, who's pulled that into the onside. They're going to think about 2.
Oh.
Beard is quick there. Fuller, they almost run into each other, and they still manage to get home safely. James Fuller is one of the quickest, if not, I think, the quickest in that Hampshire dressing room. I think he wins their 2K time trial, so their time trial of endurance, and the speed test.
Wow.
So if there's anyone you want running back to the bowler's end in that situation, it's James Fuller. As Walter, left arm over the wicket to Vince, that's pulled into the onside, not timed it again. James Vince happy with just the 1. That's 12 overs gone then, 123 for 4, 87 to win. Got to do the maths. 42 deliveries. That feels a lot, but on this pitch, very doable.
Well, it's hanging around 10s just above, isn't it, really? And there was 10 off that over, so they're sort of just about meeting the challenge at the moment, Hampshire. But, well, of course, what they don't want from here on in is a bad over. What they'd like is a very big over, maybe an over of 20 or so, which really does then put the pressure on the fielding side. They'll always be happy whenever there's a dot, whenever there's a single, and most of the time, even when there's a two, they'll be happy. They won't want to concede too many boundaries too quickly now. That's the challenge facing Essex. The challenge for Hampshire, of course, is to score regular boundaries. We've got Ben Allison back. His first over went for 10. The right-arm seamer from that pavilion end that comes in and bowls to James Vince down the leg side. That's a wide. Again, it's that angle that he bowls, isn't he, really? He bowls to the left of his front foot. His body weight is sort of at an angle, isn't it, really? So the arm comes over at an angle. So it's always spearing into the right-hander. Started too straight.
And this is why we should be on telly, Kev, because that action you've just delivered...
I need to have my back out just doing that. And he's bowling at pace doing that. It's not good for your back, I shouldn't it? 124 for four. Here's Allison. Look at that. Very open stance. Hammered away. And it's just over the fielder. Just. I think he got quite interested in the field. He got excited. But Vince got just enough on that. Six runs. Wide first ball. So that's basically one ball. And there's been a wide and a six, which effectively is seven runs off one ball.
Crowd need a helmet the way it's coming off James Vince's bat. You had no chance to even get out the way of that, Kev.
Vince moves on to 71 of 35. Hampshire 130 for four, need 80. As Allison comes in again and bowls to Vince, slower ball. Vince cracks it away off the offside but picks out the field around the deep. But Vince does move on to 72. He's still there playing well. Fuller is taking the pressure off Vince. He's 25 off 13. This is a big partnership here for Hampshire. Came together when the score was 88. That was in the ninth when Ross Whiteley was a judge caught behind. He didn't look particularly pleased with it, nor did Vince at the non-striker's end. Be interesting, I'll ask them about that at the end of the game.
The hum of the crowd. We don't even need to speak, Kev. They're doing all the speaking for us.
79 needed. It's Fuller on strike. Allison comes in and bowls. Fuller pulls that away, doesn't time it. On the leg side, but I think he's found the gap to get two. Doesn't matter, he didn't time it. Crowd really warming up to this. They've been great all night. It's been big crowd, biggest of the season so far for the T20 home matches. Still two more to come, of course. Glamorgan next Friday, depending on the result of this, that's huge. It'll be a huge game anyway. And then Gloucestershire a week on Sunday, which may yet prove to be the game where Hampshire either will qualify or not. Here comes Allison again, full. Fuller doesn't time that, goes up to mid-off. Well, Essex, as I said earlier, they won't mind a single from the deliveries they bowl. It's the boundaries that will hurt them. 76 needed. And there are two balls left on the 13th. It's a great response from the crowd, isn't it? Look at that.
Just realised how horrifically bad my maths were, because after this over, it's 42 balls, isn't it? Not the one before.
You got it wrong. Well, you're a physio, you're not a mathematician. Allison bowls. Oh, outside the off stump. Good slower ball. As Vince tried to hit that hard and missed that by a mile. Good slower ball. We haven't seen that from Allison. That was almost out the back of the hand, though.
Yeah, that's a great option, I think. And I think Hampshire varied their pace at the back end of their innings, bowling to Essex, and was really effective. So, good option, especially when the start of your over's gone for so many. Still one ball to come as well.
Hampshire scoring at just over 10.5 and over. They need about 10.25. So they're keeping up with what they need to do. Flicked away by Vince, but a single down to deep square leg. And that will be the end of Allison's over. Two overs, none for 22. Walter, the left-arm seamer, two overs, none for 19. I'm just wondering if he probably won't bowl another over straight away. With Hampshire at 135 for four, needing 75 from the last seven.
Yeah, we're in for a cracker. I'm interested to see when the captain, Harmer, brings himself back on, because for me he's been the most threatening of the bowlers. He's bowled three overs of 25 but picked up two wickets. ...of Joe Weatherly, leg spinner. He's just running to... almost extra cover to bowl at backward point, because all the fielders are out in front of the bat. There's a deep extra cover, a deep long off, long on, mid wicket and square to James Vince, and a wall of fielders on the offside at the point area, as that's bowled, and that's pushed out in between long off and extra cover. A cry of ooh, and he's thrown it straight past his friend, and they come back for a comfortable two.
Just when you think you've not pushed it too far or too hard, actually you have. You think, oh, well, just push it gently, but of course you forget the other fielder's coming towards you as well. And he's got to change.
Tosses the ball up, that's shorter, and that's hit hard down the ground, nearly taken out James Fuller. The fielder does well. Veer, who's busy, long on, keeps it to a couple. Vince to 77 off 40, 71 needed then of 40 balls. James Vince at the crease for Hampshire, alongside James Fuller, who's on 28 off 15. A conversation with Fuller and the umpire, probably, I can only imagine, about running in the middle of the wicket, but I could be wrong. James Vince looking at the umpire, asking what's going on. 139 for four then, 210 to win, as Critchley into Vince, and that's hit hard down the ground. A great stop off his own bowling by Critchley. This gets in the way, that's one. Don't want to rub your hand after that. Sunset still hovering to our right, red and orange skies, as Critchley in. Vince advances, it's high in the air, that could be taken, that is taken! All 6 for 8 of Paul Water. Celebrates to the crowd. James Vince, the Hampshire captain, has gone for 76 off 41. 138 for 5. How crucial is that going to be in this Hampshire run chase? 72 still needed to win.
Wow. 50-run partnership between those two, which has ended. Now, the way Paul Water celebrated that, I would suggest he's had a bit of stick from the crowd down there in that corner. That was a very, very... Well, that was the sort of celebration which does suggest that, there you are, I've got rid of your best player, so have that. I remember somebody, a certain person that was here, I won't mention his name, that actually told one or two in the crowd who filled in an exact position that when he got a catch there, turned around and said a few. So there's obviously a section down there which does give players a bit of stick. Water clearly enjoyed that. And James Vince has gone. That is a massive, massive blow for Hampshire. 72 needed. Two balls left in the 14th. He hasn't actually looked back, Water, since he's gone back to his mark. But that was a very loud celebration, wasn't it? The way he turned round. Dawson's in. Is it me
Benny
or you?
Benny Howe.
Oh, Benny Howe. Sorry.
It's to mid-wicket, one run. 139 for 5. Interesting that Dawson's still not been sent out to bat.
I agree, because Dawson's strike rate this year is way up on his career, so he's actually playing very well at the back end of innings, but I suppose Benny Howe probably has a little bit more there, hasn't he, over the years.
Critchley, with his leg spin in to Fuller, worked up to long one for a single. Fuller will move to 29 off 16, 140 for 5 then Hampshire Hawks, 210 to win, so 70 required on 36 balls. Critchley, 2 overs of 14, 2 wickets. Hampshire chose not to play their leg spinner of Mason Crane.
Picked up the wickets of Weatherly for 1, and James Vince there for 76. That's a big blow, isn't it? There's a dance cam on again. Give your verdict there, Emily, to what you're seeing.
Well, I see the Hampshire bucket hat, so I'm happy with that. A bit of ABBA as well, the DJ's on form.
So 6 overs left of the Hampshire innings. They are 140 for 5. They need exactly 70 from here. And it is Aaron Baird back into the attack with his skiddy seamers bowling to James Fuller. And that worked out on the onside. Fuller moves on to 30. He has a big role to play now, James Fuller. Hasn't scored many runs at all in this competition. 30 of 17 to him. And Benny Howe, who is a more than handy player coming in at this stage, has probably been a little bit unlucky. He was unlucky at Sussex, who almost won Hampshire the game. That world catch from Brad Curry. There was a very good catch actually the other night. It's Gloucester should get rid of him out in the deep. Howell plays a misses. Is he edged? Ooh, one or two of the Essex fielders got excited there. They thought that had edged. Has it gone through to Buttleman? Yeah. Hampshire have won the last two games here in T20s. Are they going to make it through?
Just a reminder what it means as well. Essex 2 points ahead of Hampshire at the moment, sitting third, Hampshire fourth. So a huge game at the back end of this competition.
There comes in. Howell pushes forward. There'll be just a single. Out into the covers. Howell moves on to two. 142 for five. What's going on with the crowd? Something's going on. I can just hear a few cheers. Emily's going to have a look. It's coming from below us somewhere. No, just can't really see anything as yet. It seems to have died down a minute. I don't know if there's a Mexican wave. If it is, it's only down this end. Here's Baird. Bowls and Fuller works that away on the onside again. Doesn't time it really as it goes out towards deep mid on. You just feel that the tension and the atmosphere has just dropped a little bit with Vince's wicket. You need to build it up again.
It felt like it was very doable, wasn't it, when James Vince was there. It was almost felt in control, whereas now the run rate required is up to 12.6.
Yeah, climbing rapidly as Baird comes in. Howell swings up in the air. Who's under that? The bowler is. Tayo's dropped. At sort of mid-on, really. It went high up in the air, and actually he's not in a great position to take that. He's taken it just a bit coming over his head. That would have been a very good take had he held on. Yeah. And even though he didn't have to go too far.
Hard catch. That was very high. Yeah. The Hampshire crowd enjoyed it, though.
Probably just as well it wasn't Paul Walter. That would have given him someone else to celebrate if he'd taken the catch later on. Here comes Baird again. Bowls. Fuller giving himself some room to add to extra cover. Fortunately, the fielder doesn't pick it up cleanly. Otherwise, they might have had a shy. I think that might have been Harmer, actually, there. End of the over. Now, Essex, you feel with that wicket of Vince, sense that they could just about finish this off. 15 gone. There are five to do. Hampshire are 145... for five. Oblivious Cam.
That should be on you, Cam. Up here.
Well, they're focusing on some people that are just sort of sitting there and probably don't really want to have the camera on a bit, looking at them. Oblivious Cam.
Matt Critchley then to continue. He bowls to Fuller, who's hit that hard straight down the ground. Beard does well coming round at long on. They settle for a single despite a little misfield.
Oh, Beard.
Fuller on 33 now. Benny Howe on 3 or 4, just needs to get going here. Same field, deep square leg, deep mid wicket, long on, long off and cover to Howe, who pushes that to a back of the point. Fuller has to hurry, misfield.
Here we get another one.
They're going to think about two, yes they do. That sloppy bit of work from Essex. They're going to appeal for run out, but that wasn't. But the backward point there, if you misfield it and it's only gone a metre and a half from you, the batter shouldn't be coming back for two there.
Ridiculous. Cushy, I think. It's almost like he was more. I don't know why he wasn't. Get back there recovering.
62 needed then. 28 deliveries. Richly in. Reverse sweep by Benny Howe. An appeal for LBW as he doesn't get hold of it. Given not out. There is something going on in the crowd. I can see exactly what it is, Ken.
Yeah.
A beer snake is being made. A very large one. As Critchley in, and that's hit over. Up towards mid-off. Towards Paul Walter. Bounces just in front of him. Crowd, no doubt, will get stuck into him down there. 149 for five, Fuller on 33. Critchley in to Fuller, and he's got an under edge, and that's gone past fine leg, who's chasing after it. The outfield's absolutely rapid. Will he get there? He does very well in the end. They come back for two. James Fuller to 35 off 21, 151 for five, just a dry spell of boundaries.
It is, just at the wrong time. Well, there was never a good time, to be honest, when you're chasing 210.
Ken, heavy need to go and look over the banner.
Is it massive? Oh, I can see
snake.
It.
Snake. It's taller than Paul Water. That's hit high in the air by James Fuller.
Oh.
Is that going to be six? Oh. Yes, it is. James Fuller has long levers too, and he's used them there and timed it for someone who's not got into double figures so far this competition. James Fuller is on it tonight. He's on 41 off 22. 157 for five. Further, 58 required off 24 balls.
Yeah, that run rate was rapidly moving forward, or moving up. Certainly help, but just a couple of balls left of that over, the run rate was over 14. Emily Windsor's keeping an eye on that snake. The beer. Here's Harmer into the attack. Howe swings away on the leg side. Four runs. One bounce. Away to our left. Benny Howe moves into double figures and it's 161 for five. Hampshire just picking it up again here when they need to.
Kev, this snake, you say it's a beer snake, there's numerous underages down there making it even bigger.
Harmer bowls. Howe swings again and there's six! That's a big one! Into the tunnel! Benny Howe!
Can't take a spectacular catch off me if I clear it that far. Over the boundary rope is what he's saying tonight. And out of the ground on the scoreboard.
That is a big hit. Howell onto 16 off 9. Just again what Hampshire are looking for. They need these batters just to keep going. Keep going big. 167 for 5 and Hampshire from here need 43. Harmer bowls and Howell goes big again, is he? Oh, he's going to be caught deep mid on. Oh, Paul Doe has palmed it over. The field has palmed it over.
That's Paul Water, I think. Yes.
It's Paul Water, fortunately. There's not so many crowd up there behind him. There's not so many to give him any stick. He better not come back fielding down this end again. He really will get, he'll get the full blast.
How good is T20 cricket?
171 for five. Benny Howe's on fire here and goes again in the air. It's wider mid-off. In fact, he's just over extra cover, in fact. He tried to get wider mid-off. Didn't quite get hold of it, but fortunately, it went over the fielder. Benny Howe swinging away here. He's on 22 off 11.
17 off the over so far.
Big over. Simon Harmer as well. 173 for five. Two balls left of the 17th. Hampshire need 37. Here's Harmer again. Quicker ball. Howe drives, but straight to extra cover. That's good bowling, Harmer.
The suspense in the crowd is just getting more and more. What an enjoyable evening of cricket where you can say whatever the result.
It's been superb, isn't it, really? It's really come to life. Oh, it's a pull toss. It's in the air. It's going down to fine leg. And has it got enough on it? It has. Four more. Harmer's gone for the fast Yorker and overdone it. And I don't think Howe really got enough of a bat on it, but fortunately, because it was a quicker ball from Harmer, it just had enough on it. Big over, that one.
Huge. I feel like that's got Hampshire right back in the game. Really impressive over. Benny Howe, he's on 26 off 13 deliveries. Hampshire require 38, and the crowd below us, I think, are booing because they're sad
that Walter's,
not being sent out. The captain's taken one for the team, Simon Harmer. I'm sorry, that's got to have been what he's done.
It's probably just as well keeping him away from there. 20 runs off that Simon Harmer over. Wow. Now we really have got a game.
Daniel Sams, the Australian, with 95 on his bat, is going to be bowling to Fuller. That's a full length, slower delivery, hauled into the onside. Will just be a single as the ball's fired back into the keeper.
It's well bowled.
The snake is still being fed below us, Kev.
Where is it now? It's just to our right. Has it moved along?
I'm going to have to go and have a look. It'll be rude not to. Can't see it. 178 for five then. 32 required. 2.5 over. Sam's in.
Oh.
A full toss. That's a fantastic diving stop from the keeper.
What's the umpire's going to do?
About the So it's off the bat, that is. Great option from Benny Howell. Those fielders are up inside the circle.
I wonder if the umpires might have thought that was a bit of a no ball, but probably wasn't high enough, to be fair. So what have we got left, Ems? We've got
31
off
16. We're in the game. Fuller on strike then on 42 of 23 deliveries. Sam's in, that's a full delivery down the leg side. Oh, yeah. Umpire stretches out, signals are wide. The cut off, Kev, at 54, we're at 47. So Sam's wanted the ball back quickly. Hampshire fell short of that in the first innings.
It's not quite to a ball, but very shortly it will be, you feel, unless there's a boundary pretty quick.
Sam's left arm round the wicket to a very open stance. Fuller, who loads and hits that into the ground. That's bounced up and over, backward point, and that's four more to James Fuller. 26 needed. 15 balls. Hampshire five down. James Fuller, Benny Howe, building a fantastic partnership for Hampshire. Special evening here at the Ageas Bowl. T20 cricket really at its best tonight. Sam's into Fuller, loads. That's a great Yorker length delivery, dug out well by Fuller. And Beard does well at long on to keep it to just the one. Fuller moves to 47, 25 of 14 balls. If that's on telly for me now,
yeah,
I'm favouring the batting team.
Are you?
25 or 14.
You think momentum's with them? These two have been together at 138 when they came together. 185 now.
Sam's. Round the wicket to Howe. Bowls. That's a York length delivery. Hit him on the pad. Not an appeal because it'll be going down leg side. So they come through for a leg bye.
Well, very 24. Shortly, yeah, I was going to say two overs to go with 24. There's one ball of this over.
Big ball, this.
It's a big ball, you're right. This is a big ball, and then, of course, the penultimate over becomes very big, doesn't it? You don't really want to be leaving yourself too much to do in the last six balls. I mean, Sam still has another over to bowl, and he's quite clever, isn't he? Even though he's gone for 39.
Sam's in, bowls, and that's hit high up into the air. That could be out. Dropped at deep square. They come back for two. Kevin James, that should have been taken. We said that was a big ball, and where is momentum? You drop a catch like that, you feel like momentum's with Hampshire. Two overs then. 22 required.
Wow.
The classic is coming on, and all the crowd are on their feet here.
A massive misjudgment really for Ozkushi, that was. They put a couple of catches down, haven't they? Takes Fuller to 49. I have. I mean, this is a brilliant game. This is an absolute brilliant game. Whatever happens now, it's been, I mean, I know last night, was it at Lord's that game in Essex? No, it was at Oval. Over 500 runs in that game. We won't quite get over 500 here, but it feels an awful lot of runs, no matter what happens from here on in. So we've got Ben Allison to bowl his third over. His first two have gone for 22. I think he'll settle for 11 off this, with Hampshire needing 22 off 12. And it's Howell to face. Howell hits it on the air, back with a point! It's racing away! It's four!
This, Kev, is an unbelievable atmosphere. I think the Ageas Bowl knows how to deliver, and at the moment the Hampshire batters are delivering.
Well, 18 needed off 11 deliveries. What a way to start the penultimate over. Allison under massive pressure now. Benny Howell has 32 after 16 deliveries. Allison, the pace bowler, comes in once more from that pavilion end. And bowls to Howell. Howell swings that away. Oh, it's gone on the 45 on the leg side of the fielder up there. But it is a single. It's 17 needed of 10 deliveries. It's less than two a ball. getting towards the end of the game. I think Hampshire would settle for this situation every time. Fuller on 49 not out of 26 deliveries. He's going to face Allison once more. Fuller, whose top score before tonight was just 8. Here he comes. Allison. Fuller swings, doesn't really get hold of that. It goes out to mid on. They may look for two here. Howell's running the first one quickly. He's running to the danger end. He's easily home. In fact, it's going to Fuller's end. But as Emily says earlier, don't throw it Fuller's end. He's too quick. And there's his half century. Can you believe it? His top score was 8 in this competition this year before tonight. He's played superbly.
And the Hampshire dressing room out on the balcony applauding that. And I think as players, you know when another player's going through a tough period, and for him to come out under pressure tonight and perform the way he has, regardless of the result, is a fantastic boost for Hampshire.
15 off 9. Fuller swings! He knows that's 6! He hasn't even watched it! It's 6 over mid on. As soon as he hit it, it was head down. He knew! We knew!
Kev, that Hampshire dressing room, I promise you then, they were all up jumping the moment he hit that. Wow! This is special tonight, Kev. I think a must-win game for Hampshire, and I think the way they're playing is showing why they're a team that's got a trophy in the cabinet at the moment, but it's not over yet. 9 runs required, 8 balls.
It might not even be close, actually, at the end. 201 for 5. Here's Allison, 2 Fuller. Fuller gets a good Yorker and he's bowled. It's just gone through. Good comeback there from Allison. Very, very good comeback indeed. Super Yorker at Fuller. Couldn't do anything about it. He goes for 57. And just when you think that actually Hampshire are going to win this with a few balls to spare. Well, there's a little, maybe is there a little twist there. What a comeback that was. But what an innings. Now listen to this crowd. Fuller is not even halfway back yet. And the crowd are already on their feet, or most of them are. The applause is already ringing around the ground, and this will go on until Fuller steps over that rope and beyond.
Yeah, absolutely phenomenal innings for a man that's been struggling for runs, struggling for form, to come out and display what we've seen tonight. Some unbelievable hitting, as well as some skillful batting, and I hope for that Hampshire dressing room it's a match-winning innings, but 9 required off 7 balls, it's still all to play for. And just as you think this game's going in one direction, another curveball's thrown at us.
James Fuller, 29 balls with 4 fours and 3 sixes, departs and enter stage left is Liam Dawson. There are 7 balls left in this game and Hampshire need 9. 8 for a tie, which actually I think both sides may settle for.
No.
I think Essex would probably settle for it more than Hampshire. I think with 9 needed off 7, I think the fielding side would settle for a tie now. I think you're right. I think Hampshire feel that they've probably now done enough to win this, but the pressure is on Liam Dawson now. The field's
interesting field.
It's in off the offside, yeah. Everybody in on the offside. Deeper on the leg side. There's always a single at least on the leg side for Dawson as Allison comes in. And bowls, Dawson, swings that away! Whoa, Dawson! He joins the party! Oh yes! First ball, look at Dawson slap the bat with his hand. He's loved that, the crowd loved that. 6 runs, first ball, Liam Dawson.
Kevin, this is absolutely magnificent. I don't think words can do it justice. The reason there was only 4 fielders out is because they've gone over time, but don't need to worry about that when they're going to clear the boundary rope like this. Every fan here on their feet. 3 needed then, of 6 balls. This has been an unbelievable game of cricket. It's not over yet, but it's very much in Hampshire's favour at the moment. 2 umpires are having a conversation.
I think there was 19 off that over. Allison had to get... Well, he couldn't really afford to go for more than 10 or 11. Oh, hello, look at you. All the moves.
DJ's delivering again. Honestly, all these little kids are out on the front row probably wanting all the autographs. They're all ready, but they're all jumping up and down. Arms waving. Benny Howley and Dawson having a conversation. 3 fielders outside the circle. Long off, long on. and a deep square leg. I'll tell you what, this crowd is pumping. Three to win then. Six balls. Benny Howell on strike. He's on 33 of 17. Played a magnificent inning so far. And Daniel Sams to bowl it. Full toss. That's played to mid-wicket. They're going to come through for a single. I'm going to be very surprised if this isn't called a no ball. It's not.
It's borderline, isn't it?
Very borderline. But two to win then for Hampshire. Five balls to do it. Liam Dawson, who's just faced the one delivery so far, and belted it for six. To be on strike.
Well, I mean, if Hampshire win it now and win it with four balls to spare, I mean, that, considering how many they've chased and how tight everything was, that would be quite a big winning margin, wouldn't it?
Crucial game as well. Essex are above Hampshire in the table by 2 points. Sams into Dawson. That's heaved through the offside for four. This crowd has erupted, as has the Hampshire dressing room, as has Liam Dawson. That's a special win here for Hampshire tonight. What a game we've had. Chasing down 210 to win, and it with four balls to spare. Special, special evening, Kev.
It's just amazing, isn't it? You know, that there are games and there are games, aren't there? I mean, that has absolutely been a roller coaster from start to finish, ever since Essex started up with that huge opening partnership of Lawrence and Feroz Kushi, 127 in the first 10 overs. And it was really only because Essex didn't really capitalise on that. They still scored a massive 209. And it looked more than enough for a long period. Hampshire were always just about there, but no, never in front, really. And there's the stat. James Vince, 76. It may not... It's a big contribution to the win. But yet again, Hampshire win when Vince scores 50 or more. And it's so true tonight. He kind of laid the foundation. Fuller, brilliant, absolutely brilliant, wasn't he?
Yeah, I think, as I said, for a man that's struggling with form to go and play the way he did, 57 off 29 deliveries, and that partnership with Benny Howe, who scored 34 off 18, and Dawson, the Hampshire stalwart, comes in 10 off 2. That's a fantastic chase, Kevin. Credit to the groundsman as well, absolutely belting pitch from where it was after the Arctic Monkeys to produce that on the outfield. Absolutely phenomenal.
Thank you, Emily. Great stuff from you. Enjoyed working with you. Enjoy working with you as always. What a win this evening for Hampshire. A four wicket win in the end, and that puts them on to 14 points, level with Essex in the South Group. We'll do it all again a week tonight. Actually, when Glamorgan are the visitors here. If you're listening on the BBC Radio Solent frequencies, then the news is next.